watching Fox Sports, home to the World Series, the NASCAR Winston Cup Series, and next January, Super Bowl 36.
Hi, and welcome to one of the newer stops on the Winston Cup circuit, Las Vegas. One of the favorite social spots as you get a look at the scenery. It's no illusion, no mirage. Great racing today, and who will hit it big? Jeff Burton once again, or how about Jeff Gordon, or points leader Rusty Wallace? Today on Fox, you'll see the high rollers of NASCAR try their luck in the third Winston Cup race of the season. The glitz of Vegas mixes with the glamour of racing in a Las Vegas show that you will never forget. Hi, I'm Chris Myers in our mobile studio just above Victory Lane at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Once again, rain could be a factor in today's Winston Cup race. Yeah. We'll keep you informed on that. We're honored to have a driver up here on our set with us, Steve Park. A big win last week with Darrell Walsh. A real driver.
Yeah, yeah, I'm
sorry, an active driver.
There you go.
Congratulations.
You have a former television.
I was going to correct him and say there's two drivers sitting up here. And we've both driven the Pennzoil.
It's a fraternity. That's right. It's a fraternity.
You should see him drive out of here when the race is over. Have you had a chance to enjoy any of the Vegas nightlife at all?
Oh yeah, of course. Every time we get the opportunity to come out here, we like to I'm not a gambler, so I like going to the shows, and I've been staying at the Bellagio and had the opportunity to take in some shows.
You're not a gambler?
Every driver's a gambler, right?
Darrell, I've heard, is taking in some shows over there.
He was usually seen him dancing with Siegfried and Roy. But let me ask you about the emotion and really off of that win in Rockingham, how you'll use that in today's race here in Las Vegas.
Well, I think anytime you come off of a win, you automatically become a hands-on favorite. So I think just taking that momentum and having the opportunity to try to win again.
Steve. Coming down to get the white flag. What happened right there?
Well, that was a wiggle, and I thought I actually got into Bobby, but right there is one of my favorite moments, having the opportunity to be the two-time winner with Dale Earnhardt.
That's a little dangerous right there. You said you're not a gambler. What if I didn't catch you?
That just goes to show you how much I trust all them Pennzoil guys. They were there high-fiving me, and I just leaped off the top of that car, and I knew they'd be there to catch me.
Let me ask you something. What was that last lap like? What was the spotter saying? I mean, I know you had to be tightening up, and I know you had to be tense.
Well, I tell you what, you've been there before, I knew that Bobby had a better race car towards the end of that race, and I needed to do what I needed to do to try to win, and that was go into a defensive mode. And I was in that rearview mirror, and I'd seen him coming, and I got up off turn four for the white flag, and I knew he was trying to squeeze up on the outside, and my car broke loose, and I was still looking out the front of the windshield, and when I looked back again, he was back. I said, maybe I just got into him.
Was you really worried about that at that point?
No, at that point, I wasn't worried about it. I was worried about doing what I had to do to either scare him to keep him behind me or block him to keep him behind me. But it was a great victory for us and Dale Earnhardt Incorporated.
You guys have got a ton of momentum right now. You know, Michael wins Daytona, you win Rockingham, you come into Las Vegas right now, but How does everything work as far as DEI right now? Is everybody on a high right now? Everybody got some momentum? Yes.
Well, it's the first time in about 15 days that we've actually seen a little bit of a smile at Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. And we've been through so much, and it's just been so hard to try to recover from that. And my heart goes out to my guys and the guys on Michael's car and on Dale Jr.'s car. I mean, they're the ones that have been working through all this tragedy and giving us great race cars.
What's it like to walk around DEI now without knowing that Dale's not there? What's that feel like?
It's been difficult, and you know yourself, you know, you keep looking around every corner waiting for him to pop out and give you a little, you know, squeeze on the arm or a little kick in the leg.
Do you feel like you got some added responsibility to that? Do you feel like you need to step up a little bit more, or how do you do that?
I think so. I think we all do. I think it's making all of us young guys grow up a little bit more, and I know Dale Jr. has just done a fantastic job of being strong, and he's gone from being a young man to being a very young man to being a man now, and stepping into a role to help Teresa.
Yeah, and DEI has a chance to, for only the second time in history, to win three straight races with three different drivers if Dale Earnhardt Jr. Could win today. Of course, Darrell Waltrip was part of that way back when he was driving.
When I was a driver.
Yes, now you're abroad, and we have to say goodbye to you for now from the Hollywood Hotel.
I know that's breaking your heart.
You have to go up to the broadcast booth. So, Darrell, thanks. We'll see you up there with Mike Joyner and Larry McReynolds. And good luck to you today, and thanks for stopping by. Have a great season.
Well, thank you, and we just love Fox.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
And now a recent development taking place this morning. Teresa Earnhardt, the widow, of course, of Dale Earnhardt, flew from North Carolina to Las Vegas and moments ago held a news conference, her first public statement with Dale Earnhardt Jr. by her side. She made a plea to racing fans and the state of Florida to help her protect the privacy of Dale Earnhardt's autopsy photos.
This is the first time I've spoken in public since we've lost Dale. Honestly, I'm not very comfortable being here. It is too soon. But this issue is of vital importance, not just to my family, but to anyone ever faced with losing a loved one and being exploited from it. Please help us by speaking out. We need you right now. Thank you for your support and enjoy the race today.
Teresa Earnhardt plans to take her fight next to Washington. We'll have more from Las Vegas. 33,333 flowers arranged in turn four here on the Las Vegas Speedway in honor of Dale Earnhardt. Welcome back to Las Vegas as you get a look at Dale Earnhardt Jr. Mentioned in driver's introductions. They're getting ready to roll here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. It's part of the No Bull 5, which hands out a $1 million bonus to a driver and a fan. And that truck is carrying some of the millions that hopefully will be handed out. More on that in a moment. We had a terrific race Saturday here in Las Vegas. Third stop on the Busch Series. Top vote out at Greg Biffle. A duel in the desert. But in the end, Bodine breaking through for his second straight victory in the Busch Series, 13th career Busch win. He will be in today's Winston Cup race as well. Let's take a look at the standings to the moment. Jeff Hammond in the Busch Series.
I'm telling you right now, would you look, you got Jeff Green, last year's champion, with up-and-coming Kevin Harvick tied, but you've also got last year's truck champion Greg Biffle and this year's Rookie of the Year in third place. I mean, strong, strong field.
Next stop, you'll see it on FX Saturday from just outside Atlanta, Aaron's 312. Coverage on FX at 12:30 Eastern, 9:30 Pacific. And as we welcome you back to Las Vegas, the odds have been in Jeff Burton's favor here as he swept the Busch and Winston Cup races in Vegas last year. Yesterday, he finished sixth in the Busch race. Today, he starts 28th. We start our whip around the pits with Jeannie Zelasco. Jeannie?
Jeff Burton finished second in the inaugural race here in Las Vegas, and then he managed back-to-back wins in 99 and 2000, and in a city where everyone's looking for the best odds, you may be the closest thing to a lock that they can get. So tell everybody you have figured this place out, right?
Well, we figured it out the last couple years, but I don't know what that means for this year. Yesterday in practice, the Citgo Superguard Tourist was really fast on a long run. It wasn't that blistering fast to start, but it felt really good. It drove well, and when our cars drive well, I don't even care how fast they go. If they drive well, things will take care of themselves. I was very happy with the way it drove yesterday, so we'll see what we can get done.
99 cars starting from the 28th position. No big thing because you won here twice when you started outside of the top 10. Matt Yoakam?
Dale Jarrett had the fastest car for one lap in qualifying to win the pole, but DJ, how fast is your car over the long run here?
Well, that's what we'll have to find out. We had a good test out here, but a little different conditions, and certainly after having races out here and things, the track's a little different. But we've made a few adjustments and see what we can do to try to keep it up front all day.
Good luck. His best finish here is seventh, Steve Burns.
Everybody comes to Vegas hoping to strike it rich. Well, Terry Labonte is one of five drivers who can win $1 million for himself and for a fan as part of a bonus program. Terry, you guys start 33rd. Can you get to victory lane and claim the big bucks?
Well, I don't know. It's going to be tough. I thought about playing that real big slot machine at the motel there. My odds might be better, win $1 million doing that. But, you know, you don't ever know. We feel like we're running pretty good. I don't know if we're good enough to win or not, but we're going to try. It's really neat to be part of this program. It's a great opportunity for five of us to have a chance at winning $1 million. And we got to thank Winston for that and the fans also, you know, that have a chance. So it's really a neat deal.
Terry, no way to sugarcoat this next probing question. Last year, at the end of the year, your car was green in honor of the Grinch who stole Christmas. Now it's orange. Can you get Tony the Tiger to victory lane?
Well, I hope so. We're going to run the Tony the Tiger car for 3 years. Next year is Tony the Tiger's 50th birthday, so that's going to be our paint scheme for 3 years. So it's a great-looking car. They did a great job designing it. We ran a Tony the Tiger car a few years ago and really had good success with it, so I hope this is going to be a good one for us.
Good luck today, Terry.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, Steve. Yeah, those Kellogg's Flakes are great. Other drivers, as he mentioned, in the No Bull 5, Jeff Gordon, Mike Skinner, Joe Nemechek, Kenny Wallace, along with Terry Labonte. Last night, Wallace spent 60 minutes on the strip in Las Vegas verbally sparring with some of the crowd outside the Holyfield Ruiz title bout.
The Okay, here we are in Vegas, the big fight, Holyfield and Ruiz. Now listen, I'm going to get me some good interviews and find out what everybody thinks I need to do to win $1 million. I need a suggestion. I need you to tell me, what do I need to do? What kind of mindset do I need?
Well, I think you need to get out in front and don't look back.
I like that. Get out in front, don't look back. Man, you look good. Hey, can I ask you something? How you doing? All right, Joyzy boys. I'm a race car driver, okay?
We know that.
How do you know that?
Because you're Kenny. Who doesn't know that?
All right. You've been in pressure-packed situations. What kind of advice do you have for me?
Pray beforehand.
Hey, I like that, and I will pray a lot. Let me ask something. Is $1 million a lot of money to you?
Well, yeah, $1 million is a lot of money to anybody.
Looky what I found here.
Be careful of the tight corners.
Right? Tight corners.
That's what the drivers tell me.
Thank you. Luck. I need luck. Okay.
And let's take a look. By the way, we thank Kenny for being a good sport. His brother, Rusty Wallace, leading the NASCAR Winston Cup point standing so far. It goes 4 Dodge and then 3 Chevys on that list. All right, let's take a look at the odds. We're in Vegas, right? So you can actually wager on these guys from the Las Vegas Stardust Hotel. Bobby Labonte, Tony Stewart, a different Tony the Tiger, and Dale Jarrett, the favorites. Let's go upstairs to Mike Joy and the guys to get their thoughts on today's race. Mike?
The only slot machine that worked for me this week was the one I put my card into to get into my hotel room. That paid off every time. Otherwise, forget it. Last year, had the rains not come, Tony Stewart was coming fast, and I think he's going to renew that charge. Might just make it all the way to victory lane. Larry?
Well, I'm going to have to go with the pole sitter, Dale Jarrett, and evidently a lot of other people's picking him because just 2 days ago his odds was 8-1, so there must be a lot of people picking him.
Well, I'm going to go with a long shot. As I told you, I'm going to go with Todd Bodine, but I got to hedge my bet a little bit, and I'm going to take Bobby Labonte to back up my bet.
Well, at least we got a last name. What a Daytona, you only picked Dale.
Well, that's not working today.
Part of the field. All right, back to you, Chris.
Thanks. Talk about the No Bowl 5. We got the Plenty of Bowl 3 up there that we look forward to with Jeff Hammond. By the way, the Las Vegas Hilton Race and Sportsbook helping us with the odds. Jeff, how about your thoughts before I get your pick on what we'll see in today's race?
Well, first and foremost, you got to watch out. The weather's back with us again, and it's coming fast. Just about as fast as these race cars can run around the racetrack. So if the weather doesn't become a factor, look for the tires to also be an issue here today. New tires, but everybody seems like they've adapted to them real well. I look for it to be really a good race and a lot of side-by-side, maybe, you know, 2 grooves today.
Yeah, Dale Jarrett, who was on the pole, said once he gets comfortable with the tires, mm-hmm. could be a big, big race for him. Yeah. Real quick, who's your pick?
My odds on favorite right now, I'm going to go with Ward Burton. This is a Dodge race. It may be a Dodge day.
All right, for Jeff Hammond, I'm Chris Myers. Stay tuned for Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas, the city where Elvis lives, even at the Speedway.
Got the pole, leads the pack. Burton's won it twice, back to back. On Speedway. Good old Vegas, place to dance. Junior's coming, he's got a chance. On Speedway. Dale's team got the floor. Walter Park wants some more. More, 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 more. On Speedway. Race is next. I got a hunch. It'll make you shake. Thank you very much.
Welcome to Las Vegas Motor Speedway, where Fox Sports presents the third race of the 2001 NASCAR Winston Cup season. Today on this 1.5 mile D-shaped speedway, they'll race 400 miles and 43 of America's fastest and finest. Stand at the ready. A tribute in turn 4 to the late and great champion Dale Earnhardt. And on a somewhat chilly day, we are set to go racing in the desert where fortunes are won or lost on the turn of a card or the brush of a bumper. Let's go down to the grid and Matt Yoakum.
Lance Burton may be the master magician on the Las Vegas Strip, but in 2001 on the racetrack, the magic belongs to Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. Two wins in only two races. Today, Dale Earnhardt Jr. rolls for the DEI trifecta. He has the motivation and the determination, but does he have enough luck starting all the way back in 32nd? Dick?
In yesterday's Busch Series race, Todd Bodine drove a car number 00 to win. Snake Eyes. Today, he starts in sixth spot in the car number 66 and hopes to motor to the front and grab the weekend's biggest jackpot. To see Burns.
Well, Dick, Johnny Benson has finished in the top six twice here in Sin City, but in 163 career starts, he's yet to go to victory lane. This team is confident. They feel like they can run the table and win here in Vegas, Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, Steve, in Vegas, the house always has the edge, and that is what Kurt Busch is banking on. Vegas born and raised, and to increase the odds, he is behind the wheel of a Roush car. The last three and the only three Winston Cup races here in Vegas have been won by Roush cars. Mike?
Been a bit of a chilly morning here, but the sun has come out and begun to warm this crowd. They're going to see some hot racing action next. Let's go trackside for opening ceremonies.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming.
Thank you very much, Trelina. Ladies and gentlemen, how about a round of applause for Trelina? Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to today's Grand Marshal, Mr. Gary Henson, to give the command to start engines.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
Las Vegas is a place of big money and big fortunes won in one day, and five drivers have that opportunity this afternoon. Welcome Welcome to Las Vegas. Mike Choi with Larry McReynolds and Darrell Waltrip. And Darrell, 10 miles away at the Stripper in Glitter Gulch. A smart gambler will often hedge his bet.
Well, these guys down here, every one of them, they gamble every week. That's what they are. They're a bunch of gamblers. This guy right here, every time I go to him, he's gambling on something. Today it's on setup, and they're doing with spring rubbers, rear sway bars, and these are things that can be changed during the race, Larry.
Well, the reason they're doing it is the unknowns, a lot like the dealer's hole card. The unknowns of how much this racetrack's going to change, and I promise you, it will change as the race unfolds, and the unknowns of the weather differences today. Yesterday, hot and sunny in practice. Today, cool and overcast.
Window that's going up. Get ready to go racing here in Las Vegas.
I ever got a ball of that dream, wherever that dream may lead. I got a ball of that dream to find the love I need. I've got a ball of that dream, wherever that dream may lead. I got a ball of that dream to find the love I need. Keep moving, move along.
Las Vegas, where too much just seems never to be quite enough. This is the land of over the top. And we're set to go racing for 400 miles. 43 starters, $4 million purse, including postseason awards, 60 to 65 laps, the pit window. Let's have a look at the starting lineup today. Dale Jarrett has his second Las Vegas pole, looking to improve on a best finish of seventh here. Johnny Benson ran sixth last week, giving Dale a little stuff there from the front row. Matt Yocum.
Ida plays forward to Burton's run for three in a row. DJ's the only driver to have four straight top 10 starts in Las Vegas, but he has only one top 10 finish to show for it. For a change in post-race scenery, he'll need a change of luck.
Row two, Jerry Nadeau has his third top 10 start of the season, and Michael Waltrip, the Daytona 500 winner. Jeannie Zelasco.
Boy, a lot of confidence from the 15 crew. The feeling is Michael Waltrip could have had the pole, but they had to hold back because they didn't have the owner's points, the provisionals to fall back on. There'll be no holding back today. Michael told me he has a very fast car, but he'll be keeping one eye on the track and the other on the sky. Weather a concern for everyone today.
Let's go to row three. Tony Stewart, second in last year's race, and Todd Bodine, yesterday's Busch Series winner. Then Bobby Labonte was fifth in the last two Las Vegas races. He anchors row four along with Sterling Marlin, who has two top tens in two races this year. The highest qualified rookie is the hometown boy inside row five. That is Kurt Busch and Rusty Wallace, who finished third here in the Las Vegas inaugural. Elliott Sadler had a strong run last week, 11th, and Ron Hornaday Jr. has raced here in the Busch and Truck Series. Ward Burton ran second to his brother Jeff here in 99. Jeremy Mayfield has one top five here. Row eight, Mark Barton won the inaugural. Bill Elliott, fourth last year. Steve Burns.
Mike, as you said, Mark Martin won the very first race here in 98. Last year he was third, but today he starts 15th. He's never started this deep in the field. They've tried three different chassis setups since they've been here. They've gone back to square one to see if they can get Mark back in victory lane.
Row nine, Blaney and Atwood, two of the four fastest in happy hour yesterday. Jimmy Spencer, Kevin Harvick, the rookie. Rockingham winner Steve Park with Matt Kenseth, the pole sitter yesterday. Joe Nemechek and Jeff Gordon. Ricky Rudd and Stacy Compton in his first Las Vegas start. Then at row 14, Robert Presley and Jeff Burton, two-time winner here, Dick Berggren.
33-year-old Virginia Jeff Burton's past Vegas strategies have paid off big in three starts here. He's got two wins and a second place, over $1 million in prize money, enough to make the tax man weep with joy. But today the odds are against him. He starts way back in 28th spot. But the guy's got a feel for this racetrack. Let's see if he can dice his way to the front. Mike?
Got a long way to come, but all afternoon to get there.
Yeah, and you know, watching him run the Busch race yesterday, he's dominant in that series as well as he is in the Winston Cup. And so I think they got work cut out for them. They don't seem to be having it dialed in this week like they should have. Matter of fact, they haven't had it dialed in any of the races we've been to so far this year. Him or Mark, either one.
Here are the provisional starters. Fill out the field, 43 cars strong.
Well, got to remember, a lot of guys that has run good here in the past, we've got that different tire here this year. A little harder tire. Everybody's been searching for the setup. A few of them have found it. A few of them still searching.
Yesterday, a thrilling Busch Series race as Greg Biffle battled Todd Bodine throughout on what quickly became a two-groove racetrack
We may get more of the same today. We hope so.
All right, they dropped three big coins in. They're reaching up to get ready to pull the handle on 800 horsepower.
Getting ready to say ka-ching here in Vegas.
Ka-ching, here we go.
Green flag. We're racing.
Well, either Dale got a great jump or Benson wasn't ready. One's out there because Dale shot right out in front of him.
Johnny Benson started like he still had his money in his pocket while Jared pushed his chips right to the front of the table.
He was waiting for the bars to come up.
Jeff Burton, snake eyes on lap two. They'll come to the caution to begin lap three, which for us will be all year a silent lap. Under caution, we'll pick up with Jeff Burton, who has come to the pit lane. Heavy damage to the left rear of his Ford.
Yeah, it's going to take away any chance he's got to win, and they may be able to get the car beat out here, prepared to get back out, but no, he's going straight to the garage. Let's see what happened to him. Just up in that outside groove, and the car wobbles a little bit, and around she goes. I mean, the car was just extremely loose. Larry probably had a couple of spring rubbers laid up in that right rear, and that's not good on the start.
Nobody near him. It just come around with him. You know, could be the low air pressure. These guys run real low air pressure to start of a race because it builds so much. That could have been what bit him here in early part.
Yeah, you can watch your car, and it just, there's nobody in.
Jason Leffler, no one, just barely getting by.
Yeah, he didn't make any contact. So car just comes around, and that's heavy damage, and they took it straight to the garage. He didn't even stop in the pit. Let me show you what happens. He goes down in the corner, and I'll show you what loose is. Obviously, you saw what it is. You come down in the corner, you come through the corner, you're chasing the car up the track like he was doing, and all of a sudden that back end snaps around. Now, here's what happens to your hands. Left, 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 whoa, back to the right. And that's that little wobble you see. If you watch him on the replay, you'll see his car bobble just a little bit, and that's the hand motion that you get. And then this is the result you get right here. Backs that thing right up in the wall, and that's a hard lick. Look at it another angle here. Boy, everybody's lucky to get by, and he went high and got out of everybody's way, and he held it up there.
So caution is out quickly here in Las Vegas. We'll be right back. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Dodge and the UAW, by Budweiser with the crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer. This Bud's for you. By Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse, Lowe's Improving Home Improvement, and by Pfizer, where life is our life's work.
They just waved the green after a quick three-lap caution period. And once again, Dale Jarrett tries to step away from this field. This time he's got Nadeau with him in a battle for third. Johnny Benson being challenged by Todd Bodine in the 66.
Yeah, Bodine is wasting no time. I mean, he jumped right up there. He passed a couple of cars in the first lap, and he's got his sights set on lead. They got that car like he had that one yesterday, Larry. That thing is awesome.
Well, I talked to him this morning. They took a lot of the pieces and parts, information from that car yesterday, especially in the shop package, and they put it on his car this morning.
Got a car smoking back here, the 32 car.
Ricky Craven, a lot of smoke from the back of his car.
as he rolls off into turn one. We stay under green, and he'll be posted on the black flag board. Meanwhile, Jeff Burton's car is being worked on in the garage. Here's Matt.
And Frank Steiner and company working on the 99 as Jeff Burton looks underneath the hood, trying to figure out what happened to his car. Jeff, what happened?
That's a good question. I don't know. I got in the corner and got in pretty easy. And when I got just before the center of the corner, it started coming around, and I wasn't on the gas yet or anything. And it started, and I never could get it to stop. I do not have a clue what happened. It's 2 weeks in a row that I turned around, and I don't ever turn around. So I don't know what the deal is. I'm driving a car. There's only one person driving the car. I don't know what to do when you're driving slow in a big pack and you just spin out. I mean, I don't understand that.
Well, the good news is he's okay, but last week at Rockingham, he slapped the wall, and again, trouble today.
Seventh place battle, a good one, but now Ron Hornaday backing up.
Yeah.
And in the wall, one car spinning at turn two, slam in the wall. Rusty Wallace, another of the favorites.
I think there must be oil in the turn over there.
Well, Ricky Craven, here comes Craven around to the caution again, still out on the racetrack.
Isn't that 2 and 12?
That's teammates, 12,
yeah,
Jeremy Mayfield, 2 and Rusty
12.
Wallace.
And they're torn up big time.
Now first, Brett Bodine spun and hit the wall. That brought out the caution. And then in turn two, Wallace and Mayfield spun up into the wall.
Yeah, I think there's oil on the racetrack, no question about it.
And what a day for Rusty Wallace. He come in here, even though it's early, as our points leader.
Yeah.
Jeremy Mayfield, the 12 car, through the garage this morning. Everybody said, watch the 12 car. He will be the man to beat today.
Well, let me tell you, if there's Craven still going around just smoking like crazy, got to be losing a lot of oil out of that car. I think you probably see a trail coming out. But let me tell you something about Jeremy. We saw him last year have the fastest car on a number of occasions, and he always seemed to find trouble, and he's found some more today.
All right, this reminds me of that day at Talladega when Neil Bonnet walked back to the garage after the latest of several big wrecks, and I said, well, Neil, you've raced with those fellas. Who do you think's got a shot to win today? And he says, the pace car's got a good chance at it.
There's Rusty.
There's Rusty. There you see him getting oil right here, spinning to hit the outside wall. There's Jeremy. He got clipped by Dale Earnhardt Jr. in 8 car, and he gets into the outside wall.
Yeah.
Jeremy had started 14th, and already he'd come up to 8th place. Now there's Brett Bodine at turn 4. He was the first car into the wall.
His car just went straight.
Yeah.
You got to believe he hit oil as well.
I think he either hit oil or else he'd already had a tire problem because that car never even acted like it wanted to turn.
Pit road is open. Most of the leaders elect to stay on the racetrack.
Car's heavily damaged. You can see the left rear tires all bowed in, and the car's torn up big time.
Bill Elliott comes to pit road.
Yeah, he's got wheel marks all down the right side of his car. Man.
I think I made a mistake. I think Bill Elliott's the one in the 9 car that got into Jeremy Mayfield.
Yeah, not Junior, right. We have completed, more or less, 10 laps here at Las Vegas. You're watching NASCAR on Fox.
Well, as you can see, they're rolling the car back, but there's all kind of oil right here on the ground, right where that car was sitting. That thing was leaking a lot of fluid out on the ground. And it looks like they're taking it behind the wall.
5 cars have had problems in this race, and all Fords, either into the wall or behind the wall.
Watch that. 11th car will come out of nowhere there and just hit the wall.
You see, he didn't get loose or anything. It's like he just maybe hit the wall straight into the wall.
I'm sure. And you know what started that? Jeremy got into Rusty. Jeremy got into the left side, left rear quarter panel. We look at that again. You're going to see Jeremy get into Rusty just a teeny bit.
And that's 2 of the 3 Penske cars, leaving Ryan Newman out on the racetrack.
Well, Jeremy's car is beat up, but let's see if we can take a look at this and watch right here, these 2 cars. Watch what happens. Watch Rusty wiggle a little bit. Jeremy gets a little loose, I think, and then corrects. He gets up into the side of Rusty.
All right, you see the 12 car. He's straightened out. There's the 9 car we talked about coming through there. Bill Elliott there. He's going to come through there, and just right there, clip Jeremy. That's what sent Jeremy to the outside wall.
So this may or may not have been due to oil on the track.
Yeah,
hard to say.
I don't think they're related. I think the 11 car had some sort of problem down here on turn 4, and I believe Jeremy just clipped the back of Rusty and turned him around down here. But obviously there was a bunch of oil dripping out of the cars.
Budweiser, official beer of NASCAR, sponsors the Bud Pohl Award to the fastest qualifier. Today's Bud Pohl winner is Dale Jarrett. Since 1979, Anheuser-Busch has awarded more than $7 million as title sponsor of the Pohl Award program. Riding around under caution with the race leader, our UPS cam on board Dale Jarrett. Robert Yates Ford, you saw the pace car pull in. We're getting set to go back to green.
Man, single file restart. You can't pass to the left till you cross the start finish line. How about that Todd Bodine? And we've only run about two green laps, and he's already drove from sixth to second in the 66 car.
Yeah, he kind of snookered Nadeau when they come back to the line, but I tell you, he's going to the front in a hurry. Look at this. He's coming up off that corner. Looks like that car did yesterday. Got a lot of acceleration. Got that Robert Yates power.
And Todd Bodine, who has not led a Winston Cup race since in 2.5 years, September 98 at Richmond. Here he goes under Dale Jarrett. And trouble for Ricky Rudd.
Ricky Rudd.
He's got a flat left rear tire. Flat left rear tire. 28 car. He'll get to pit road. We got a new leader, though. Todd Bodine in the 66 car. Took him about 4 green laps to get to the front. And he's running that high groove, Darrell, just like he did yesterday.
Just like he did yesterday. I believe Ricky Rudd's going to probably get that tire cut down somehow.
This is going off into turn 3.
No, it was already going down, and it bottlenecked everybody up. Look at this gaggle of cars here, man. Oh, my goodness. These guys are racing like it's the last lap. Come on, guys, get single file. Let's go.
Rusty Wallace behind the wall. Genie is with him.
Rusty Wallace, I know you're not supposed to be in the garage right now, but if you have a moment for us, you just keep saying, I can't believe it, I can't believe it. What happened?
Yeah, I went down into turn 1 on the outside. Car's running great. And Jeremy, we got blocked up on a couple cars earlier, and it got Jeremy in a 14 car on my rear end. And I was trying to drive away from him. I went down to turn 1, and Jeremy got underneath me and just lost it. And that's what happens a lot of times. You get real tight with a car, you lose air to your rear spoiler. And I guess he just lost it and got up into me, and that's it. We're tore up really bad right now. We're trying to get it back out there.
That's what I was going
to
ask you. More important, can you get back out there?
We're going to try. They're working like crazy on it right now.
Okay, tough start for the points leader.
His pesky Ford teammate is back on track, Jeremy Mayfield.
Yeah, you know, what happened to Jeremy was he got down under Rusty, just like he said, and he in the back end broke loose with him. That little wobble that we saw in the 99 car, Burton there, but this time Rusty was out there and he clipped his Rusty as he kind of tried to gain control of it.
Rookie Casey Atwood in the 19, the fastest car in yesterday's final practice, battling Winston Cup champ Bobby Labonte's 18 and Elliott Sadler's number 21 for.
Bobby Labonte was one of the cars in 18 I talked to this morning, and we talked about adjustments in the opening. Darrell, I didn't know you could put so many spring rubbers in a rider spring. Again, spring rubbers you put in there, it stiffens the rate of that spring, really makes a car turn. They thought with the overcast conditions, the cars would be tighter, wouldn't want to turn.
Let's update the lead change for you, show you how Todd Bodine got to the front. Darrell, the drivers used to say, running the Busch race Saturday doesn't help me a lot for Sunday, but now that the cars are so similar Saturday or Sunday, what might Todd Bodine have learned that's allowed him to do this?
Well, he just took the lead right there, as you can see. He just blew right by the Dale Jarrett. I believe two things, for Todd particularly. A lot of confidence on the winning yesterday, but shocks, I believe that they're similar now because they got the same, close to the same horsepower. And tires. I believe that the guy that's got the most laps on these tires right now is the guy that's figuring things out quicker than anybody else.
Todd Bodine opening up 0.7 seconds on Dale Jarrett. Jerry Nadeau, Tony Stewart. And back here at 11th place, Michael Waltrip in the 15, trying to hold off Sadler. You're watching from Mark Martin. And the Pfizer Viagra cam on board the Jack Roush number 6. That's Blaney just ahead. In the 93, Dave Blaney, who had a great run at Rockingham Monday, 6 days ago.
Yeah, short week.
Only feels like last week, Darrell.
Short week. Everybody had to hustle like crazy to get out here. Matter of fact, we heard him talk about changing Mark Martin's car over to the car he's racing today once they got out here.
And let me tell you about that car. That's a brand new car, the 6 car, and it's what they call a Roush Burton car. It's an in-house built chassis at Roush Racing, and a guy that had a lot of input on it was Jeff Burton. He's starting to really get involved in the building, plus the safety of these race cars.
Yeah, he's really
into the seat technology. That's an area that he's really been working in with some doctors and engineers. And that's what it takes to get all those problems we got solved, is everybody getting involved and getting people involved and coming up with solutions.
Now you see the 12 car right out there in front of Todd Bodine, that's Jeremy Mayfield. He is still on the lead lap, but he's losing ground fast to the leader. What he needs right now, you see the left front's just a smoking, so he's going to have to get to pit road. But he's on the lead lap. What he needs right now more than anybody in the next half a lap is a caution.
Ricky Rudd is two laps back in the 28th in front of leader Todd Bodine.
That's too bad for Ricky. He has a good car, and he's running well, but, you know, having to come in and make that unscheduled stop.
18th place. Here's Bodine's teammate, Jimmy Spencer, as you watch from the Bud Cam on board Dale Earnhardt Jr., who has come from 32nd to 20th.
Jeremy's really smoking off a turnover. I think he may have cut that tire down.
Kevin Harvick, 29, the rookie for Richard Childress in the midst of that. And
there's the tire. Left front tire is cut down. That's that smoke we saw.
That's when you say it's not rubbing no more. You know why? There's no more air in it.
That's right.
Well, Spencer had a run on the low side of Jeff Gordon's Chevy. And here comes Harvick down low on Spencer.
In the 29 car right there, right awful below the white line on the front straightaway.
This is one of the few tracks where you can do that and still talk about it the next lap.
Yeah, actually, you can pass pretty easily down there. It's real flat, and the transition from the apron up onto the track doesn't upset the car.
Earnhardt Jr. in number 8, around the outside of Kevin Harvick.
It's so great to see this at Las Vegas. This is something we have never had in 3 years. We've got two, even almost three racing groups. These guys can race side by side through the corner.
Yeah, we saw that yesterday in the Busch Series. They were moving that groove up, up, up. And before this day's over with, they'll be up closer to the wall yet.
There's part of Jeremy Mayfield's tire sitting to the inside of the backstretch.
Well, Larry said he wanted a caution. He just about got one. He made it himself.
There's two distinct grooves being run. Todd Bodine in the 66 running the second groove. Dale Jarrett in the 88 car running the bottom.
And a lot of that where you run has a lot to do with what gear selection you make. If you got a real low gear in the car, you might want to keep it tight around the bottom. If you got a higher gear, you might want to free it up and run it around the top and get that momentum off the corner.
Right now, pretty much the clock says these guys are running the same lap time around here, running two different grooves.
And they're about 1.8 seconds ahead of Jerry Nadeau, Tony Stewart, and then it's a gap back to Johnny Benson, Sterling Marlin, and Ron Hornaday back at sixth. Yep, Stewart's coming. He's got Nadeau and makes the pass for third place.
And you mentioned it in opening. A year ago, if it hadn't been for the rain, that man was probably going to win the race had he not had the rain come or had a problem.
Well, you know what? Doctor Who has probably got his package in there today.
Caution is out, and it's for that debris on the back straightaway. So this will be the third caution of the day, and it comes out at lap 26.
This will be a break for Ricky Rudd. He will get one of his laps made up, and what he'll be able to do, he's been the only car to be lapped down. We go back racing. He'll probably come in and get four tires. He'll be able to start at the front of the pack next to Todd Bodine, but we may see the rest of the leaders on pit road since we've run 27 laps.
Oh, yeah. I think everybody will come on pit road. Todd Bodine had trouble in the pitch yesterday. I believe, and this is no disrespect to that team, but unless they did a lot of practicing over the winter, this could be his Achilles heel as the day goes on. They got to pick it up in the pit today, boys. Come on, Larry boy.
There you see Jeremy Mayfield doing the Vegematic impression on that, $400 Goodyear tire?
And I'm seeing a lot of other debris come off the car besides tire. I saw some aluminum come off, so that's probably the biggest reason aluminum sitting out there.
Dick Bergeron.
Well, we're surprised to hear that Ward Burton is loose, because yesterday everybody was talking about their cars being tight. They're going to try to fix that on the pit stop. To Matt.
A lot of teams have built-in adjustability. Dale Jarrett is one. Todd Parrott just asked Dale, how is your car after only 16 or so of green flag laps? He said the car is just a tick loose. Steve Burns.
Well, Matt, Tony Stewart's going to come down to Greg Zipidelli's crew. I just talked to the crew. They said we're not sure about the chassis adjustments, but we're definitely going to put on four tires, even though it's early.
And you know, everybody's complaining about being loose. That's not unusual, Larry, because what happens is you talk about push, car won't turn. Then when you get ready for the race, you make them too loose to start the race.
You jump the fence.
You go
on, too many adjustments.
Too many.
Here's our triple split. You'll see the pit stop times in the box. Here's Steve.
And Tony Stewart's in Greg Zipidelli's crew working to the right side. So far, no chassis adjustments to the number 20 car. Left side tires going on for Tony Stewart. Let's go to Matt Yoka.
A chassis adjustment on the 88 car of the pole sitter, Dale Jarrett. The 20 car is already out on pit road. Dale Jarrett now away. He will beat the 88 car. Dick Berggren.
Ward Burton is in, and crew chief, Tommy Baldwin, is the rear tire changer. You rarely see a crew chief go over the wall anymore, but Baldwin's the man. And they are having a long struggle in the right rear, taking that spring rubber out to try to adjust the car to get rid of the push. Baldwin running way behind because it was his job to do it. Takes extra time, not his fault, just the way of the world. Tough break for Burton. He takes off at the very tail end of the pack.
But Tony Stewart's team was dealt a pat hand, drew no cards. 14.4 second pit stop puts him up front. We're under caution at Las Vegas. This is NASCAR on Fox.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Miller Lite. Grab a Miller Lite. It's Miller time.
Rusty Wallace's car has been retired. The damage too severe. He joins Brett Bodine and Jeff Burton. His car's in the garage area after just 30 laps.
And he was one of only two cars that he had both top 10 finishes in the first two races. Here's Brett Bodine. Jeannie, are they going to get Brett back in?
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll ask Brett exactly that. Larry McReynolds wants to know if you're getting back in here.
Yeah, we're going to make it back out. Hopefully we got all the bad luck out of the way for the Bodines today. Todd's got a great car out there, and I'd like to see him win both of them this weekend. We just got in the oil. You know, unfortunately, NASCAR didn't get a yellow out fast enough, and looked like Rusty Wallace and myself were the two victims.
Sit, you wait, working on that right front suspension very heavily. Steve?
This is the left rear tire that came off of Ricky Rudd's race car. There's a cut right here, and I want to show you exactly how much damage it did. This is the outer liner. This is the inner liner. They call it a tire within a tire. It's cut all the way through this outer liner.
But the inner liner kept him from being down on the rim and maybe into the wall.
Right.
Yep.
He's one lap down. He'll be the only car on the inside of Tony Stewart on this restart here. He can't jump Tony, but he can maintain speed with him and try to make that other lap back up.
I believe he's good enough to do it. He looks like he was running along pretty well.
You hear him come up through the gearbox. We're back to green. Stewart and Jarrett take off. They have Ricky Rudd as a buffer before Todd Bodine, the third place car. And here's Ron Hornaday, number 14, that green Pontiac of A.J. Foyt, challenging Johnny Benson.
Yeah, I was watching him before that caution came out, and he's got a really good car today. He's really made up a lot of time through
the
turn.
Look at the 66 right there on the outside. We hadn't even completed a lap since we went back to the restart.
Do you think he didn't learn something from yesterday? That's the way he looked yesterday.
Let me tell you about Hornaday. Ron, they call him Rocket Restart Ron Hornaday on the West Coast and in the Truck Series. He and the late Richie Evans, the best restarters I've ever seen. Here's Bodine up alongside Dale Jarrett. He goes on into second place, and he's flying, Matt.
Todd Bodine asked for a little air pressure adjustment. His car was just a tick tight on the 66 car. He's going for the lead. He said his car was very good, but they're just trying to make small adjustments because they have found on this new tire, a small adjustment means a big adjustment.
This weekend, this fella's in another zip code.
I'm telling you, he's doing the same thing he did yesterday, folks. Yep. He may not have seen the telecast yesterday. He drove around them on the outside. He drove around them on the inside. Doing it again today.
And I don't care where we're at. When you drive by Tony Stewart and Dale Jarrett on the outside, you're good.
That's right. I know it scared Dale Jarrett. I saw him wiggle a little bit when he looked over and saw Todd going by.
Now here's Jarrett trying to mount a run on Stewart for second place.
Sterling Marlin in the 40 car there. He's done moved up to fourth place as well in the silver car.
I got races going on everywhere. Dale Jr. and Ryan Newman, they're all fighting along there with Robert Presley.
Two Fords, a Pontiac, a Dodge, and the Chevy in the top five.
Nope. This is a battle for 19th right there, 19th position. See, Ryan Newman in the 02 car, the rookie, on about only his second Winston Cup start. He is the third Penske car we talked about, the only one that don't have problems.
Boy, Bill really jumped up there on the outside. He got a good run, got a good bite. you can pick that throttle up early in the corner. You can do that to a guy that's trying to keep it low. You get by him on the outside.
Meanwhile, Dale Jarrett moves for second around Tony Stewart. And here's Sterling Marlin also passing Stewart's Pontiac.
Now, it's not unusual to see that happen to Tony. I've seen Tony struggle for 10, 15 laps after a restart, but the longer that car runs, the better it gets. And I think you'd attribute that to Doctor Who.
And Doctor Who is who?
He's the Shock Man.
Okay.
I like that. I love that name. When Tony said that the other day, I said, yes, that is exactly who he is.
Well, we have little kids, and I was thinking all the Who's in Whoville. That was on Terry Labonte's car last year. All right, Todd Bodine has jumped out to a 1.3-second lead. Dale Jarrett now has passed Tony Stewart and is trying to track him down. But the man who's coming hard and fast is Sterling Marlin in the number 40 Dodge. Back here is Marlin on the right side of your screen. He's got to get past Ricky Rudd's lapped car to have a chance to challenge, but that's pretty much been the fastest of the Dodge fleet these second two races.
Yeah,
so
he's
far.
He's had great start to his season. The car's run well and handled really well for him, and everybody thinks he's a guy that can win this race today.
Bobby Labonte, that green number 18, just went past the number 20.
How about the yellow car here, Steve Park, the one car? He started 21st last week's winner at Rockingham. He has already moved up into the top 10 in the ninth position, challenging the 10 car of Johnny Benson.
Well, I talked to him in the pre-race show, and he said he was happier with his car than he was unhappy with it, but they had a little work to do. They made some changes this morning. Looked like they were right.
Now here's Hornaday underneath Stewart's Pontiac, and that will change fifth place. Stewart trying to battle back on the high side. There's quite a crowd right behind them. There's Nadeau, Benson, and Park.
Hey, Ron Hornaday's got a good car today, guys. His car is really getting into the corner. Watch how he opens up on Tony Stewart getting down into three there. Right around the bottom on the white line. Accelerating up off that corner, and you got the one back here that looks like he's getting through the turns really well, too.
And they're all going to work their way underneath Tony Stewart. More on Steve Park's number one. Here's Steve Burns.
Darrell, you mentioned last week that more than 50 teams were out here testing, but surprisingly, the number one team did not come out here. Crew Chief Paul Andrews told me this morning he did not want to burn up a test because he felt like the track would change from January until now.
Well, that's the advantage of having multi-car teams. I know Michael came and tested, and they can share information, and they feel like the cars are similar enough that whatever worked for them, for Michael, would probably work pretty good for Steve.
And what they're talking about burning a test, NASCAR only allows a team to test seven times over the course of a year. Unless you're a Rookie of the Year candidate, then you can test 12 times.
Yeah, they give the rookies a few extra tests because they've never been to some of these tracks before, so they give them a little opportunity to catch up.
Benson and Park battle side by side now. Johnny Benson's number 10 Pontiac, the Park's number one Chevy.
Yeah, as good as Park's car looked, and he's coming back on the outside there. Benson drove under him going into three. Turn three is a little tougher than turn one. One, you kind of arc it down in there. It's a little more forgiving. Turn three, you've got to drive it to the end of that straightaway and then cut it right to the bottom. It's a lot tighter getting into three than it is into turn one.
Riding with the Home Depot cam on Tony Stewart's Pontiac, watching the battle ahead for eighth place.
What I don't like about this right here, if I'm Johnny Benson or Steve Park's crew chief, guys, I know it looks good. You're running side by side. You're racing, but it's early, and that leader's getting smaller and smaller up there.
Yeah. And there he is, Todd Bodine with a 1.3-second bulge on Dale Jarrett. 0.8 seconds further back, Sterling Marlin, then Bobby Labonte, and Ron Hornaday has fought his way up into the top five. 42 laps complete at Las Vegas, and Todd Bodine, yesterday's Busch Series winner, is trying to double down here in Las Vegas. Green flags waving. We're back racing here at Las Vegas.
Luck be a lady tonight. But if you've never been a lady to begin with, luck be a lady tonight.
There are a lot of glamorous places to stay in Las Vegas. The billion-dollar Bellagio, Caesar's Palace, the MGM Grand, and there's the Hammond Hollywood Hotel right above Victory Lane.
Hey!
Daryl, you left the set too soon.
Jeff, you know, when they...
I got out there in the nick of time.
Jeff, when they said this this mobile studio had everything, I had no idea.
I'm telling you right now, Chris. Hey, you know, Daryl told me, he said, look, one of these days you're going to go up that mountain and bring something back special. Well, Chris, I brought something back special just
for us. Yeah, and I want you to explain the chassis and attitude a little bit later, if we can do that.
Absolutely.
You can do that?
We'll get in that discussion.
Too much drag, I see.
All right, now who has the tickets for Carrot Top? All right, back to you guys in the booth.
Okay, have some fun, guys.
All right, good luck.
Talk to you a little later.
Race has been great.
You guys have a set of templates down there?
Yeah.
You know what hurts my feelings? Jeff and I were supposed to be doing a package deal here together as retired crew chiefs.
Uh-huh. Let me tell you the package deal. That's that 88 closing in on that 66. He's getting a little closer every lap.
Rod Hornaday, a green 14. Johnny Benson picking up fifth spot from Hornaday. There is a race going on, fellas, down there.
Yeah.
We'll explain it to you a little later.
I see now why they just do a pre-race show.
The hometown hero is Kurt Busch, Las Vegas native, and he's trying to hold off Jeff Gordon for 13th place.
Just an update. They must have found what was leaking on Ricky Craven's 32 car. He is there. He's back out on the racetrack, but he's a bunch of laps down, just trying to make laps and finish the race today.
I know he's disappointed because he had such a great run last week, and I really thought he had a good car for today. That's unfortunate to get in trouble like that early on.
15th place battle, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Chevrolet inside.
Bill's car. Bill's been moving up, you know, pretty well. He's run the high line and seen him get around several cars running up on the outside. He's making some progress toward the front.
And here is Benson. He's on a roll. Hot shooter, he's got Bobby Labonte, and that's for fourth. And for the lead, Dale Jarrett goes after Todd Bodine.
Yeah, I don't know, Todd's car looks like it's got picked up a little push. He didn't make any changes on his pit stop. The car might be tightening up, track's getting a little rubber down on it from the race so far, and I think Dale's a little better than he is right now.
This is the telemetry off Dale Jarrett's 88 car right here. You see going down the front stretch right here, see the little green jelly up there indicates where he's at on the racetrack. Off into turn one, Darrell, a little bit of brake right there.
Probably a whole lot of brake right there.
You saw it turned probably about 8,900 RPMs. It's coming off turn two. He's off the brake. Going down the back stretch, RPMs climbing. You'll see it turns less RPMs going into turn three than it did turn one. About 8,400 going into turn three, a lot shorter straightaway on the back stretch.
Yeah, and plus he gets a little draft off of Todd going down the front straightaway here, and that really picks up the RPM as well. And that's kind of that gear thing you play with.
Both the Joe Gibbs cars backing up a little bit. Here's Bobby Labonte surrendering fifth to the number 14 of Hornaday. His teammate Tony Stewart is back in ninth.
The thing about the 18 car, Bobby Labonte, I wouldn't worry about him yet. He's just kind of biding his time.
About Michael Waltrip in the 15 car there, started in fourth, backslid a little bit after the pit stops. He goes by Bobby Labonte.
And I guarantee you, he ain't biding his time. He's got the bit in his mouth. He's going, baby.
Jerry Nadeau now coming up to challenge Labonte, and this will be for seventh place. Up front, Jarrett just keeps gnawing away at the low side on Todd Bodine.
Yeah, you get bogged down coming out of that turn over there. It's a little slow coming out of there, but he really gets a run on him off of turn four here coming down the front. I'd say they probably got a little different gear selection. Probably a 370 and maybe a 380. Todd's got the 380. Jarrett's got the 370. He's coming down the front here, and you'll see he's getting a little draft off of Todd, so you see quite a bit of RPM. About 8,800 getting in there. Has to use a lot of brake to keep it on the bottom. Here he comes up off turn two. Can't quite get under Todd off of two. Has to drop back in behind him. Try to get under him going into three here. He's going to take two different lines. Dale's going to go to the bottom. Todd's going to stay up around the top. Should be a drag race off turn four.
Now for the lead, Jarrett on the bottom, and Bodine has a full car length on him.
And the spotter's telling Dale Jarrett, just keep doing what you're doing. You'll get him. You just keep inching up under him like that. Pretty soon you'll get by him.
about 180 miles an hour going off into a corner, running side by side with each other on a mile and a half flat cornered racetrack.
Yeah, I mean, we sit up here and we just, folks at home don't have any idea how fast these race cars are. 180 mile an hour on a mile and a half racetrack is flying, baby.
When those cars go into turn three, that camera up on the roof is not quite half a mile away from them, so it's such a long shot. Here, as they come by, you'll get a little better sense of just how quick they are and how quick Sterling Marlin is coming into the picture.
Yeah, he's really gained. He's cutting into that lead. I think that the two leaders right now, Todd and Dale, are up there racing each other, and that's allowing to Sterling Marlin to close up in a hurry. But I like this. You got one down low, you got one up high, and that makes for some good racing.
That's what fills these seats. And here goes Jarrett.
Got a good run off
turn
four.
He's got him. This looks like Biffle and Bodine in yesterday's race without the contact.
I'm thinking that Todd probably at this point said, all right, I'm going to let Dale go. He's making me run way harder than I want to right now, and I'm going to follow him a while and see what he's got.
Well, the brown suit came to the door Tuesday with a package and said he didn't want to race his truck. I explained it to him. Dick Bergeron.
Ron Hornaday started in 12th spot. He's motored his way to the 6th position, and he has called his crew, and he has called his spotter, and he has asked for help. The help he wants, what's the best line? He wants to know where the fast guys are running, high, low, or in the middle. It's like there's fast guys in all those places, Mike.
Hornaday in 6th. Now, his last lap, a 33.98, that's only about a tenth of a second off of what Dale Jarrett ran on his last lap. Steve?
Well, Tony Stewart, as we said a moment ago, when they pitted, they took on four tires, but they didn't make any adjustments to the chassis. He has radioed his crew, and he said, I am loose, but they are set up for the long runs. They'll be good, better, longer if it stays green. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Due to the early caution flag laps, a number of teams were not able to get a good read on their fuel mileage. Larry Carter told me they feel the 66 car can go about 60 laps playing it safe. I spoke with Doug Yates this morning. He felt like the 88 car could go around 68 laps. The 28, which is a lap down, could go 70.
Jeremy Mayfield coming back out on the speedway.
All right, folks, as a driver, the start-finish line is our reference point. So whenever we're talking to our spotter about track position, where is everybody, we always refer to the leader is at the line now. That way we can feel, we don't know about 2 or 3 seconds, the driver doesn't. He only knows about where he is on the racetrack. So as you go along, the spotter will tell you the leader's at the line now, and that tells you where you are relative position to the leader, and you can usually tell if you're gaining or losing some because of that. Now here comes Dale. He's coming down to the line, and the spotter would say that 88's at the line now. And then wherever you are around the racetrack, were you on the back straightaway or wherever you are, they would tell you, there comes Michael, and he probably knows where the leader was.
And we're looking at him, Darrell, because these last four laps, he has been the fastest car on the speedway, running 2 to 3 tenths quicker than the race leader. So Michael Waltrip pops up onto the leaderboard, and he's on the move, 63 laps into the UAW-Daimler Chrysler 400 in Las Vegas.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Kellogg's, the official breakfast food of NASCAR.
Welcome back to Las Vegas, where Dale Jarrett, the pole sitter, puts a lap on rookie Ryan Newman, the Purdue engineering major. He's going to run the ABC Tour this year. Some ARCA races, some Busch races, and some Cup races. Now, the five drivers eligible for the $1 million no bull bonus and the five fans paired with them. Jeff Gordon in 16th, Nemechek 17th. The best of that bunch.
It's not looking good for the fan that might win $1 million today.
Kenny Wallace, 36, he's already went on
a lap down.
And Vegas has not been good to him. In three races, he's never finished better than 39.
Wow. You know, some tracks are like golf courses. Some golf courses don't accommodate the way you play. Some tracks don't accommodate the way you drive.
No golf course accommodates me.
You the hacker.
Putt-putt?
Maybe.
Oh, what's this all about?
Well, this is Mike Wallace trying to stay on the lead lap in number 7.
See, one thing that'll do, that'll slow down Dale Jarrett and allow some of these other guys to close up a little bit, like Michael. He's back in there and coming pretty fast.
It's only two cars lapping under 34 seconds, Darrell, and that is Johnny Benson and Michael Waltrip. Here's Michael, and there's our Fox Tracks giving you his instantaneous speed around the speedway.
He's going around Kenny Wallace there, and see how fast he's going up the back there. It's 180 into turn 3. Now, that's the slowest part of the track, I mean, actually getting into that turn compared to what you're going to see. Watch what that thing does going down into turn 1 now. See, he's already over 184 miles an hour. Now, there he is after Benson. This is cool. Accelerate up onto the straightaway. Benson's 180 into 3, just like Michael was.
I think that's why Michael's faster. He went through the middle of the corner a lot faster miles prior than Johnny Benson in 10 car deep.
Picked the throttle quite, but let's see what Benson does. Well, he pulled off him. But let me tell you something, 184 miles an hour down into turn 1. And then you wonder why, when something happens to one of these cars, they go into the wall, and you say, God, didn't look that bad. You tried at 180 mile an hour.
It used to be there were only two tracks in NASCAR where you could run that speed, Daytona and Talladega.
Everywhere we go now, we run 175 mile an hour, 180 mile an hour down the straightaway, and we go into a place next week. You want to see some speed, wait till next week. Atlanta, we'll be over 200 trap speed going into the corners.
For more on Johnny Benson, here's Matt.
Johnny Benson started second, dropped to fourth, but he is reeling in the 40 car of Sterling Marlin. He radioed in to crew chief James Zantz. His car is getting a little loose, but let's not make any adjustments. They were a little surprised by their great qualifying effort. They felt like this car in testing would race better than the second car they had out here during the test, which was faster on short runs. They also had an unknown because of the Busch race going after happy hour, a new process this year, so they were a little unknown about some things, Steve Burns.
Well, Matt, Michael Waltrip on their last pit stop, they also decided not to make any adjustments to the number 15 car. After about 20 laps, the car started getting better once the tire pressures came back up. They expect to pit by about lap 87 in about 13 laps.
Well, the problem with the car that's good on the long run, as you can see here, I mean, Michael's car is starting to come in, but he's 13 laps away from a pit stop. So it takes too long for him to get going. By the time he gets going, the leader's way up ahead of him, and so he's always going to be behind. He's got to do something to pick his feet up on the early part of his run.
Yeah, Dale Jarrett is now running 34 seconds flat. You see there's what's that song? Nothing in my rear view?
I don't know that one.
Okay.
I got a hot rod Ford and a $2 bill, and I know a place just over the hill. It's Hollywood
Look at the gap.
Hotel. How'd they stuff all that stuff in that hotel down there? That's a little bitty room down there.
Long gap back now to Todd Bodine, 3 seconds. It's a further 1.3 seconds back to Sterling Marlin. But Johnny Benson is gaining on Marlin, as Dale Jarrett leads him here in Las Vegas. 76 laps are complete. This is NASCAR on Fox.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Pep Boys, Cars Like Us, People Love Us. By Warner Brothers' new motion picture Driven, in theaters everywhere this spring. This film is not yet rated. By Dodge and the UAW. And by the Home Depot, the official home improvement warehouse of NASCAR.
Laps are complete here in Las Vegas in front of over 120,000 fans, as pole sitter Dale Jarrett leads Todd Bodine now by 2.8 seconds.
Yeah, we got some good information here, boys. I'm telling you, I like that little thing like that, and you see how fast these guys are running. It gives you a real perspective of just what these guys are dealing with. These are fast race cars. I know TV, they don't look all that fast. These things fly.
Michael Waltrip is still the fastest car on the racetrack. He and Johnny Benson, and now you see Benson closing.
They're definitely Johnny Benson in the 10 car is the fastest race car. That's the top three cars right there. Dale Jarrett, 88, Johnny Benson in the 10, Todd Bodine in the 66. We're about 10 to 12 laps away from pit stops. The reason James Entz and Johnny Benson, even though they're a little loose, they don't want to adjust this car, is what you're seeing. He's done drove to second place. And being a little loose here, not sideways, but the tail end just coming around a little bit, you can run a lot faster around this racetrack than with that front end's not turning.
There's a drivable loose. And when the car is a drivable loose, that is a fast race car.
And it's turning.
That's
right.
You've
got to have that.
I've had my cars loose like that, and you like them. You don't complain too much about them because they're fast. Got a lot of guys starting to make pit lane here, guys.
Robbie Gordon has been in. Jason Leffler.
Here comes the 93 car.
And he almost missed pit road.
Yeah, he did. No.
Both the Bill Davis Dodges are in, Ward Burton and Dave Blaney. You see on your screen.
It's a tough pit road to get in. You come right off of that track, and you come off the banking, not a lot of banking, but that transition, and it shoots you out away from your entrance.
And Darrell, pit road speed's 45 miles an hour. We've been seeing on the Fox track, these guys are running 180 miles an hour. It's hard to judge 45 miles an hour.
It is, and plus you know you've got to make up all the time you can to get to the end of pit road, because that's the difference of making a good stop and not. Here comes Sterling in.
Sterling Marlin, fourth place car. Comes on pit road, and Jeannie's waiting on him.
Well, gentlemen, just like you were talking about, you have to be careful on pit road. That's exactly what Sterling's crew just told him. Hey, slow down. Be careful out here. He started eighth. He's currently fourth. He's making his way to the pits because his car is a little tight. Air pressure adjustments on all four tires, and the fuel is what you're seeing here. And Sterling Marlin will be back on his way.
We saw Tony Stewart with a 14.4 second stop. That's been the standard of the day. Marlin's out at 16.5.
Now, what I always worry about after a pit stop is the crew. You complain about the car. There's only a number of things you can do and do a 14 second stop. The easiest thing to do is let air out of the tires. And I'm always cautious right after I go back out on the racetrack, because that's when you can injure a tire and have a tire problem when the tires are down on low on air.
Mike Skinner surrenders the lap to race leader Dale Jarrett. Jeff Burton and Brett Bodine have both come back out on the racetrack after time in the garage.
Here comes Tony. He's coming in, getting a bowl of Frosted Flakes here. They're great.
I thought that was Terry.
Oh, well, it looked like Tony the Tiger to me. Here comes Michael. He's coming in. Here comes the one car. They're starting to peel in one at a time here.
Steve Burns.
And Michael Waltrip down pit road. They'll make a small air pressure adjustment to the left rear. Chip Sheets on the front tires. Greg Osborne on the rear. Rick Goodrich is the jack man. Jeff Miles is putting 22 gallons of gasoline in this car for Michael Waltrip in the 15. Good stop on the right. Left side tires going on. 16.6 seconds for Michael Waltrip.
Casey Atwood's in. Mike Skinner, Johnny Benson's in. The third place car for Steve Park. John Andretti is also on pit road.
Now, Larry, up until they tighten up on these fuel cell cans, you know, I come in and I call them after I'd pit, and I'd say, hey, did you get it full? And they said, no, we didn't get but two cans in it.
Matt?
The 10 car has already come to a halt in his pit stall. It will be a four-tire stop for Johnny Benson. They are going to adjust the car a quarter pound of air pressure in the right front to help with edge rate, and he's down and away.
66 is in. Here comes Todd.
And Dale Jarrett's in.
About 20 away.
That's Todd Parrott, the crew chief.
Stop on the sign.
Dale Jarrett in for his pit stop. The two biggest guys are going to work this pit stop. Barry Muse, the jackman, 6'2", 250 pounds. Steve Allen, gasman, 6'3", 240. They're not going to change anything on this car. They are very pleased with the way this thing is running. Bodine is in as well.
Todd Bodine completes his stop as Kevin Harvick, Jeff Gordon, Bobby Hamilton, Ken Schrader, Robert Presley, and Ricky Rudd come down the pit road. Nima checks in, Kenny Wallace, Jimmy Spencer, and Jerry Nadeau, all making pit stops. Stacy Compton will get a penalty for too fast down pit road. Jeff Gordon stopped.
I wish these cars had one of the little buttons on them, Larry, like an Indy car has, so you could hold that button down and it wouldn't exceed 45 miles an hour. Indy cars have at, and you hear them go down pit road popping.
Yep, they really do have a cruise control, so do Formula One cars. Bobby Labonte picked up 5 bonus points for leading this race on the last lap, and now he's in. Dale Earnhardt Jr. completes his service and comes out.
Tony Stewart's in almost again, almost missed pit road, misjudged the entrance down there.
But big picture, think about big picture, guys, and who led a lap under it before he pitted.
Matt?
Bobby Labonte reporting into his crew chief, Jimmy Maycar. His car was just a little bit loose. They have a lot of built-in adjustments with spring rubbers that you guys talked about earlier. The 20 car, his teammate, Tony Stewart, also on pit road. Both of these cars raced at home less 14.4 seconds for the 18 car. Stewart now down and away. Both of these cars competed last fall at Homestead, a race which Tony Stewart won, and Bobby Labonte clinched the championship.
Ron Hornaday out.
Mark Martin is in. He had assumed the lead while all these other leaders had pitted, so he'll get his 5 bonus points for leading the lap.
Dick Bergeron waiting for Mark Martin.
Marcus told his crew that they just need to he just stalled the engine. Martin has stalled the motor. He had previously told the crew, just change something, get the chassis just right. Wow, they wound about 6 rounds into the right rear. This engine is still. He has not been able to fire the engine. There it goes. Finally, Mark Martin gets it going. Mark Martin, 17.9. Slow stop for Mark Martin as these things go.
And pit road is empty of lead lap cars. Elliott Sadler is the race leader.
He goes by the line now. He just passed by the start finish line.
And let's show you Tony Stewart's entry into the pits.
This is coming through turn 4 here. He's waving his hand. That's telling the guys behind him, I'm hitting pit road. Here he is. He should have been already down there. Just barely gets it on pit road.
Whoa.
Here he's going for the grass right there.
Probably somebody was behind him and he had to get that hand up and that distracted him as he turned onto pit lane.
Steve?
Guys, just wanted to add what they did to that number 20 car of Tony Stewart's. They added a 0.5 pound of air in the left rear. Also, we mentioned earlier, they are one of the teams that did not test. And Larry Mack, you mentioned they only have 7 tests. They want to go to Martinsville and Bristol, places where Tony wants to improve.
So there is Stewart. Elliott Sadler missed the entry to pit road. Now, he was leading the race, and it's just what you talked about.
Well, it's the trickiest pit road. There is too fast. I can't get stopped. I'm going to spin out, but I'm going to have to make another lap, but I'm going to lose a lot of time while I'm doing it.
As you saw, he comes off of the banking, and it's not a lot of banking, but the flat is dirty. It's got sand on it. If you hit it too fast, that thing's either going to spin out, run through the grass, or do what he did, take her around one more time.
Costly for Sadler. Those were the first laps he'd led in 2001. And Johnny Benson, after pit stops, is the new leader. Dale Jarrett in second. Sterling Marlin is third. Todd Bodine and Michael Waltrip are the top 5 after green flag pit stops. We've completed 94 laps. This is NASCAR on Fox. We're back. We're under caution for a 2-car crash in turn 2. John Andretti, Joe Nemechek. So pit road is open, and the leaders are all right back in.
Yeah, even though they were in just momentarily, just a few laps ago, they're back in there again to get those right sides this time. Get some fresh right sides.
And Johnny Benson leads the pack back off pit road once again. Show you what happened to put us under caution as they worked to remove John Andretti's car from the turn 2 wall.
I see in Nemechek, they go into the first turn there and get real close. Oh, you just look at Nemechek. It's just pulling the back end of his car around, and it just keeps pulling it, and they run out of racetrack. Into the wall they go. That's a classic example of taking the air off the guy's spoiler. I mean, that outside car is just pulling that inside car with it, pulling it around. There's nothing the guy on the inside can do.
And what a shame for Andretti. He started 38th in the Petty Dodge and was running 18th.
Well, that's a big hit for both cars. They just get into turn 1, and that's 185 mile an hour in that corner, folks. In that car on the outside, he's got a hold to that one, that air on that
car from the outside has got to hold the one on the inside, and it just keeps pulling it. There's nothing he can do. He can't gas it, he can't brake it, he can't do anything.
How much of an effect was Kurt Busch right behind Nemec?
Well, that just adds, it just adds that much more to it. Not only has he got the car on the outside pulling it around, he's got the car behind him taking air away, so he's in that kind of zone where there's nothing he can do.
Dick Bergeron could update us on pit stops.
Well, Dale Jarrett came in, took four tires. He said the car was just a tick loose going into the corner, so they adjusted a bar in the back end that they call the track bar. You see, Burns?
Dick Michael Waltrip came in. He just took right side tires. He's been complaining the car is a little bit loose. His crew chief just said, hey, get those tires worked in good. Get ready to go. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Johnny Benson was very happy with his car. They only took on two tires. That's why he was one of the top cars off pit road. This caution was a big break for the 66 car at Todd Bodine. His car turned tight on that last set of tires. Jeannie Zelasco.
Well, there's two things the A crew likes. They like the green flags because they say their car is running really well through the long runs while others have to slow down. The other, a quick pit stop. 14.56 when they just came in. Junior was going to come back through and take two more tires, but he missed the entrance to pit road, so he's going to stay back out there, guys.
All right, here you go. Here's what we talk about all the time. This is why the crew chiefs, this is why you miss pit road. Crew chiefs saying, hustle, hustle, hustle to the end of pit road. And then when you leave pit road, they're saying, hustle, 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 get back up to speed. These are ins and outs. This is how long it took Dale Jarrett from the time he entered the pit road until he got back to the start-finish line. And you can see Jarrett, Marlin, they were so much quicker than Todd Bodine and Michael. I mean, that made up a bunch of time on the racetrack.
Everybody back on track after pit stops as we work the fourth caution flag of the day here in Las Vegas.
Welcome back to Las Vegas under caution, lap 101. Let's take a look earlier. Chris Myers with Jeff Hammond. A sloppy start to things as defending champ Jeff Burton, who has won the last two races at Las Vegas, got into some trouble on lap two.
Yes, he did. Tires probably a bit cold, got away from Burton and up into that turn two while he went.
Then on lap seven, Ricky Craven, it appeared that something was leaking from his car. You can see the smoke.
I believe he had some oil line loose on that car.
Brett Bodine here on...
He got into the oil.
Lap nine had some trouble, and then points leader coming into this race, Rusty Wallace, with his teammate on the Penske team, Jeremy Mayfield.
Yeah, it's just really unfortunate. Jeremy looked like he pushed up and got into Rusty, and around he went, and on lap 96, there come Joe Nemechek getting into the 43 car of John Andretti and up into turn four while they went.
7 leaders, 9 lead changes. A Roush Racing team member has the lead at the moment, Mark Martin, as they're getting ready to go. The green is back. Let's go back up to Mike Joy.
Car's trying to get a lap back on the inside. It's Lou Elliott Sadler, and this is a dogfight to get out in front of the race leader.
Well, it really is, and you know what? For the first time this year, and I know it's only the third race, but Mark Martin is going to lead a lap up under green. So that's a big turnaround for that team over what we've seen in the first couple of races.
And look who's up to second, Ron Hornaday, the two-time champion of NASCAR's Truck Series.
Ron's doing a mighty fine job today. So far, so good for him.
Stacy Compton in the 92 car. Now, he's not the third place car. He's trying to get to the front, a lap down, get to the front, hopefully make this lap up. Got a fast race car right now, though.
Yeah, it sure looks like it. He's coming up on the outside of Hornaday, and Hornaday's he's putting them down pretty good, too. So that's a good move for Stacy.
Two young guns right behind them, the 8 of Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the 97 rookie Kurt Busch.
Got all the kids at the front right now.
Yeah.
Might turn into a kid's playground before the day's over with.
Here comes one of the old masters up on the outside, number 9, Bill Elliott. They're at 5th place, and Johnny Benson in 6th.
You know, Mike, I don't know if you've told the story about the 9 and the 92, how the numbers came about, but why don't you tell the fans about that, because I think it's very interesting.
Elliott started his career with number 9, sold his family race team, his and his dad's and his brother's race team, to Harry Melling, Michigan industrialist. And then when Elliott went off to drive elsewhere, that number 9 stayed with the Mellings. Harry Melling passed away last year. Bill Elliott came to drive for Ray Evernham at Dodge, and they asked to use the number 9 and made a deal with Mark Melling, Harry's son, where the Mellings would also switch to Dodge and receive some factory support, and they changed their number to team 9-2, as in 9 also. So it's 9 back with Bill Elliott and 92 for the Mellings with Stacy Compton.
So he's 9-2.
Right.
Or 9 also. Or
also wouldn't fit on the door.
It didn't look good.
All right, we see the 6 car of Mark Mark first place, 8 car of Dale Earnhardt Jr., Bill Elliott in 9 car. What happened on that last caution? These guys elected, since they only had a few laps on their tires, to stay out for track position. Again, we had only run 4 or 5 green flag laps since they pitted under green. These guys said, hey, I want some track position. I want to see what my car can do up front.
Mark Martin was 33rd at Daytona, finished 20th at Rockingham, and now he is out front. Battle for third place, Bill Elliott, Ron Hornaday.
One down low, one up high, and Bill should have the advantage off the corner.
Elliott takes the spot and sets chase after Earnhardt Jr.
Boy, I'm glad to see Dale Jr. up there running good. This is good third for him after what's happened to him the last couple of weeks.
You're riding with Dale Earnhardt Jr. there. Closes up on the lap car, Stacy Compton.
Compton's holding his own, man. I mean, it's he could get a break here. But see, after a caution, you'll see some different cars at the front almost every time. Guys go in, they make adjustments. They may get one of those spring rubbers out, or they'll make an air pressure change, or a wedge change, and all of a sudden, a guy that wasn't very good, he's a rocket, and he's up in the front and going like Mark is.
You know, a fan may ask, well, the 92 car, he's so far behind the 6 car to make his lap up. Why is he racing Dale Earnhardt Jr.? Just on the last caution, we had about 3 race cars that made their lap up because they beat that leader back to the start-finish line.
But Compton slid up the track just a bit, and here comes Earnhardt.
That opened the door right there, and Dale will drive down under him, and he should have position going into turn one.
And how about the 10 car, Johnny Benson? He was one of the cars that did pit, and he's back to 5th position right now.
More on Dale Earnhardt Jr. Here's Jeannie.
Well, guys, as you were saying, it is great to see Jr. running so well, and quite honestly, it's great to see him get past the first lap. A lot of encouragement here in the crew, and obviously an emotional day as Teresa Earnhardt made her way to the track and had a press conference earlier this morning asking for race fan support. It was a dose of reality, really, before the race for Junior. If for even one instant his mind wandered from the tragedy, he was thinking about it again, but he says he is in full support of Teresa.
This morning I asked Tony Urey Jr., who is not only the front tire changer on this car, but also a good friend of Earnhardt Jr., how's the young man doing? And Urey said that he is doing incredibly well, given the circumstances, that he's thoroughly focused on the race car, communicating extremely well, and holding up, given these very, very difficult circumstances under which he races today.
You know, this city has a great awareness of NASCAR racing and appreciation for Dale Earnhardt. Last night at the Ruiz Holyfield fight, they had a moment of silence in honor of Earnhardt, rang the ringside bell 10 times, and today, the Flying Falcons from the 422nd Test and Evaluation Squadron here at Nellis flew the missing man formation, and that's something that's only very, very rarely done in honor of a civilian. So as we remember Dale Earnhardt, Mark Martin leads this race now by 1.8 seconds.
That's a great tribute, and I tell you, if Junior gets up here and gets after Mark and takes the lead, this place will come alive, baby. These people will jump out of these grandstands.
His two teammates have won this year as Earnhardt Jr. chases Mark Martin. Bill Elliott third, Ron Hornaday, and Johnny Benson the top 5. This is NASCAR on Fox.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Chevy Silverado. It's not just any truck, it's the truck.
Welcome back to Las Vegas. It's another full weekend of racing across the Fox networks, beginning Friday on Fox Sports Net with Winston Cup qualifying live from Atlanta. Then on Saturday, we're on FX with the NASCAR Busch Series race, the Aaron's 312, and then NASCAR Winston Cup final practice. On Sunday, start your race day with NASCAR This Morning on Fox Sports Net, followed by the NASCAR Winston Cup race on Fox, NASCAR Victory Lane at 9 p.m. your local time on Fox Sports Net. It all comes from the Fox Networks, your new home for NASCAR. 10th place battle. Bobby Labonte trying to take it away from 24 Jeff Gordon.
Yeah, I think Labonte, I still believe he's got a pretty fast car. I think he's just taking care of his car right now.
And what happened right there, Jeff Gordon overdrove that corner. He tried to beat Bobby Labonte, getting in the corner. Look at the price he paid coming off the corner.
Yeah, he didn't want to give up that spot, but he overdrove it.
Right behind them, 88, full center Dale Jarrett. And the 29, rookie Kevin Harvick. This is the Richard Childress team. They have put the number 3 of Dale Earnhardt on a moratorium for 1 year. And I noted today, even the NASCAR credentials for that team have been changed to 29. That's the number they'll use for Harvick in that white Chevrolet.
They've changed the uniforms, the car covers. Right now, there's nothing that's symbolic of the 3 black car.
When you see that car right there, that 6 car, when you see it around the inside of the racetrack with that left wheel down on that white line, that is traditional Mark Barton right there. And when he looks that good and when his car's handling that well, he is somebody you're going to have to deal with. That thing is right on the bottom, right where he likes it. Oh, there's a pass.
Benson and Hornaday going at it again. They've been in close contact all race.
Johnny Benson in the 10 car, he caught Ron Hornaday in the 14 really quick, but barely got to him, and it's like he couldn't get by him. And I think what we're having, we hear it a lot at racetracks with speeds at 180 miles an hour, is the aero push. What happens when you get up behind the car, it takes the downforce off the front end of it, and the car won't turn.
Yeah.
Todd Bodine, meanwhile, has caught Bill Elliott in that race for third. Look at how sloped the noses are of these cars, folks. As the air flows over that nose, the car needs that air pushing down on the front.
When you get behind the car, you lose it all.
You get lift, actually, which is a nightmare for a driver. And then, like we saw a little bit ago with Nemechek and John Andretti, if you get, oh gosh, man, you ought to see that right there.
There it is.
There it is.
That's just what I about jumped out of my seat.
Oh.
Ryan Presley on the high side with Mike Skinner in the middle, one of the Noble 5 cars, and Michael Waltrip. And now that brings Ward Burton into play.
And the problem was they was 3 wide, but 2 of them was on apron.
Oh, they were all over the place.
Well, let's let you enjoy some nearly 800 horsepower on each of these cars and let the pictures tell the story. Take your surround sound at home and just give that knob a big crank it up. Michael Walter 15 and Robert Presley 77. They're all fighting for 18th position. They're your biggest gainers in this race. Dale Earnhardt Jr. from 32nd at the start to second place behind this man, number 6, Mark Martin.
Mark's car continues to look really good, and Dale Jr. does too. And Elliott's right there just in hot pursuit of Dale Jr. So got some good cars running at the front right now. Guys have got their cars adjusted around kind of like they want them. Things are looking pretty good for some of these guys.
You know, we talked this morning about looking for a percentage, a statistical average that would help evaluate the performance of these NASCAR drivers. Baseball, you have a batting average. Football, you have a pass completion advantage. Basketball, you have a field goal percentage. Maybe percentage of top fives or percentage of top tens of first starts is something that would be kind of helpful or useful. Winning percentage doesn't really tell the story, especially of one season.
Yeah, because we run so many races, and our point system is based on an average, you know, the guy that has the most consistent finishes. So, yeah, it's hard just to determine off of wins alone, but let me tell you one thing. Off that graphic we saw earlier, these guys never get a chance to rest. They are always in the pit. In the pit, they got to hustle. On the racetrack, they got to hustle. And what Steve got going on down there, Bill? What'd you find out?
Hey, we're hustling. We're doing a little fuel mileage thing down here, Daryl. If you've ever wondered how the teams figure it, they know that a gallon of gas weighs just a hair over 6 pounds. They know, depending on the weather, exactly how much more over 6 pounds. This is a gas can that's full down at Steve Park's pits, 83.7. This holds 11 gallons of gas. That's how much it weighs with the can. They'll put two cans in at a gas stop. Then what they do is they go over to a scale, which is right next to the pit box. It says do not stand, so don't ask me to get on it. But they'll weigh how much fuel is in the can. That's how they know how much they actually got in, and then they can start figuring out how many laps they can run.
Now, in addition to all the teams running the same tires, they all run the same fuel. It's provided by 76. It's a leaded racing gasoline. It's 110 octane. Don't try this at home.
It comes from pumps right here that has tanks in the ground, and you can go there, and it's got a reading on it, just like you do at the service station, that'll tell you how many gallons. The reason they weigh it, I'm the crew chief. I need to know now how much our fuel mileage is, right? Start figuring right away toward the end of this race.
Right, you can't just measure the volume of gas left because some might have come out the overflow.
You have to pour everything, even in a little catch can, back in the fuel can before you weigh it.
Mark Martin has a 2.4 second lead here at Las Vegas. Bill Elliott, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Todd Bodine, and Johnny Benson are our front five after 129 laps. Welcome back to Las Vegas. 400 miles of Winston Cup racing today on Fox, and they're about to get the crossed flags from the flag stand. It signifies we're halfway. Jeff Burton spun into the wall on lap two. Rusty Wallace and his teammate Jeremy Mayfield got tangled up at lap nine. Lap 26, tire debris brought out the caution. At lap 96, Joe Nemechek, who's just returned to the racetrack, got tangled up with John Andretti. So four cautions thus far, seven different leaders. Dale Jarrett has led the most laps, 42, but Mark Martin in three laps from now will eclipse that.
Got Mark Martin in the sixth car. He's almost 2 seconds. Bill Elliott's chopping a little bit off there as they went down the back straightaway in the nine car. And then you see Dale Earnhardt Jr. over 2.5 seconds in the eight car behind Mark Martin, the leader. That's first, second, and third right there.
Actually, I think Bill is closing the gap a little bit, Larry, as we move along here. He and Dale Jr. have been able to maintain pretty good distance between them, but I believe they're closing down on Mark a little bit.
You know, Darrell, I've watched this race unfold, and it has a typical Las Vegas look here.
Yeah.
I mean, Mark Martin, I won't say he was struggling, but the only way he got a lead earlier was by staying out. Now he's maintained the lead, and he's running at the bottom of the racetrack. I'm seeing Todd Bodine, who just drove by everybody on the outside earlier. Now he's not struggling. I mean, he's sitting there running in fourth position. Jeff Hammond, you're out there. What do you think's going on?
I think what's going on right now, Larry, is it's getting a lot cooler out there, so the racetrack has definitely changed to the driver since the start of the race. The other thing is, talking with Jimmy Finnick earlier this morning, they weren't happy with their race car yesterday afternoon, but they looked at the weather, they made a little bit of a guess, put some rubbers in the right rear, make a couple of minor adjustments, and they said they would start the race a little bit looser, anticipating a racetrack coming to them. And right now, Mark's in his zone. He's got that number six car. Jack Roush is working right down on the bottom like he used to do.
Just talked to Todd Parrott about his car. Dale Jarrett, his driver, led so many laps, and now he is running an 11th spot. Parrott said there's really no problem with the car. They're not concerned at all. And you are right about Mark Martin in his zone. He just radioed to his crew and said those simple words he says so often. We've got a good race car. Look out for that number six. Matt?
From about 30 minutes before race time until now, the temperature's dropped about 9 degrees down here on pit road. I spoke with James Ince. The temperature is not really affecting their car, although they are hearing a number of cars are complaining about turning to the tight side. I talked to Larry Carter, crew chief on the 66. He says his car is tight, progressively getting tighter, hoping to make some changes on their next stop. To Jeannie.
Well, the A car is one of the cars complaining about the tightness. He said the car's been consistent all day, but yes, Matt, as you said, the temperature has dropped and it is becoming a bit of a problem. Nothing too terrible. They're talking Junior through it because it'll be a while before he can stop again.
Dale Earnhardt
Jr., 1.3 seconds back of Elliott, who is now within a second of race leader Mark Martin.
Yeah, if I'm Mark Martin, he might like his car, but I tell you, somebody likes their car better, and that's Awesome Bill. He's got that Ram Charger coming to the front.
Cheryl Crosong leaving Las Vegas. How about Mark Martin leading Las Vegas? He has led every one of the Winston Cup races here. He won in 98. He led 82 laps. In 99, he finished 10th but led 17 laps. Last year, he finished third and led 33 laps. And today, Mark Martin's led 44 of them.
I thought she was going to talk about the Cheryl Crosong. All I want to do is have some fun. But I see I'm not the only one.
I think Bill Elliott is having some fun right now.
So
he is running down Mark Martin.
Yeah, in about five laps, he has chopped over a second off. But now, remember, let's set the stage here. You got Mark Martin in the sixth car, Bill Elliott in the nine. These guys did not pit the last time, and they're about 10 to 12 laps away from pit stops. Dick Bergman, what are you hearing down there?
Well, they have not said anything at all yet about pit stops down here in the sixth pit. I'm sure that they're just going to hang on and wait and see if they get a caution flag. But you're right. It's a five-lap differential between that sixth car and the rest of the field.
Yeah, but he's got that five or six laps. It's not that big a deal. It's not a lot. And, man, he's been out in clean air ever since they dropped the green flag.
The only thing that makes it a big deal, Darrell, for fuel reasons, he'll have to pit before those other guys, and the thing they don't want to happen when they're on pit road and the other guys are still out there is a caution come out.
Larry, I told you, let me have some TV time. Well, you ain't been on TV all year. I got to get my new sponsor some TV time, man.
Johnny Benson battling Todd Bodine. This is for fourth place. Benson trying to take it away. He's on the low side.
Just
and
remember,
does.
Ricky Rudd there in the 28 car behind these guys, still a lap down from having that flat tire earlier in the race.
There's some cars back in here that are really running well. We haven't mentioned them very often, but the 97 car in the top 10 and the 29 car, guys, he just keeps easing up through the field.
Harvick doing a good job today. There's Benson on the inside, moves past Jeff Burton, who spun and popped the wall on lap two. 143 laps complete here at Las Vegas. Mark Martin leading Bill Elliott. We'll be right back with more NASCAR on Fox.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas brought to you by Autotrader.com, the biggest, best used car site on the planet. By Sears, the good life at a great price, guaranteed. By new Haviland Motor Oil Technology, formulated for improved gas mileage. Add more life to your car. And by Visa, the preferred card of NASCAR. Visa, it's everywhere NASCAR fans want to be.
Welcome back to Las Vegas. Mike Joy with Darrell Waltrip and Larry McReynolds. 147 laps down. Bill Elliott has gone to the lead. And there's a bunch of changes.
Well, I'd like to be down there in Ray Everhand's pit right now. Because, you know, I mean, we talked about Dodge at Daytona, and they had a great outing, obviously. But Bill Elliott right here leading this race, and this is a different kind of race than what we saw at Daytona, obviously. But this is a big deal for the Dodge guys.
Also, a lap ago, Sterling Marlin's Dodge passed Todd Bodine for fifth. So, you know, long runs.
They've got the eight car coming on pit lane. I think it's Dale Jr.
It is. So green flag pit stops begin at lap 148. Jeannie?
Yeah, guys, the 8 car forced to pit earlier than expected. He's noticed a vibration. Now, they think it is a tire problem, so he's going to get 4 new ones. A slight adjustment to that left rear. They're going to take a little air out, give him a little fuel.
This one, Larry, about 10 laps early.
Well, but if he's got a vibration, again, he was one of the cars that stayed out a while ago, so this is not a bad move. You don't want to stay out there. And what they all wanted to do is get to what we call the window, which was lap 140. That means everybody, if they come in after lap 140, they can go to the end of the race on one more pit stop.
So Bernhard Jr. has done that and comes back on track. Bill Elliott, your leader, Mark Martin. And Jeff Gordon moves past Steve Park, as Bobby Labonte did 2 laps ago. Now, this will change 10th place. Stacy Compton, Buckshot Jones pit. Dick Bergman is in the leader's pit.
I'm with Jimmy Pennick. And, Jimmy, how soon will you pit, and what will you do to the car when Mark Martin gets here?
We're going to pit probably about 6 laps, and we're going to take some wedge out. We ended up being a little too tight on that run.
Okay, have a good stop. Let's go to Steve Burns.
Dick with Paul Andrews, crew chief for Steve Park. Paul, what is Steve saying, and how can you get the car better? What will you adjust?
Well, we're a little tight up off and a little tight in the middle. We're going to do a little air pressure adjustment. We'll just see what happens. You know, we're a little off here still, but I think we still get a good top 10 out of this thing.
Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Johnny Benson's crew chief, James Ince, told Johnny about three laps ago we would like to pit any time from lap 155 on. He's now talking to JB on the radio. James, what changes, if any, will you make?
Well, right now, this little Babbling Pontiac's pretty good. We're planning on bolting on four Goodyears, cleaning the windshield, going back out there.
Right now, he is in the third spot. This is his best run here at Las Vegas since he spun back in 1998 trying to enter pit road when he finished fourth.
The 16th place car, Kurt Busch, is on pit road. Rookie up from out of the NASCAR Truck Series.
And just doing a whale of a job today. I mean, he's been in the top 10 and he's quietly just stayed there. Hadn't really had any trouble at all.
Most of these guys pit right now are guys that didn't pit on that last caution. They're all having to come in a little bit early.
I tell you, when they come down off of the pit lane up there, it gets mighty crowded. Those spotters have got to be on their toes.
Now, Dave Blaney was the last car on the lead lap. Brings his Bill Davis Dodge in.
Just like before on the green flag stops, his teammate Ward Burton in the 22 car is on pit road two.
Chassis change. Adjustment, rather.
Yeah, folks, we're going to watch them as the ticker's running. Just see how quickly they can do those right sides.
Stalled the car.
Stalled it a little bit.
Ward Burton, his teammate, coming in.
Ooh, that was almost a miscue.
And if nothing else, it took Ward Burton's train of thought from getting into his pits, held him up, and under green flag conditions, running around here 33 seconds, every second counts.
Well, as that graphic we showed a little bit ago, the ins and outs, how long it takes you to get back to the start-finish line is going to be way down on Ward's car.
But, Darrell, as you come out of the pits in one of these Winston Cup cars, as tightly restrained as you are in there, isn't there a tremendous blind spot to the right side?
Yeah, there is. And, you know, you got to depend on the crew and the crew chief. He's watching for you. The spotter's watching for you. You got a lot of people watching out for you. You got to listen to what they're telling you.
Jeff Gordon is in. Steve is there.
Boy, Casey Atwood had her.
And on the 24 DW, they're going to take one round out of the right rear. That's the adjustment of the 24. Four tires. Todd Gant on the front tires. Shane Church on the rear tire. Chris Anderson is the jack man. Jeff Craven putting in the gasoline. They've made the chassis adjustment of the 24. Now going to the left side tires. Left side tires on. Good stop for Jeff Gordon. Let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Johnny Benson slides into his pit stall. This will be a four-tire stop. They are tearing away the tear-up on the windshield. The windshield a little oily as they come around to the left side of the car to Dick Bergring.
Mark Barton in. They have already taken the wedge out. You heard Jimmy Finney talking about trying to get the chassis the way he likes it. Right sides are all done. Doug Gould's got the gas in, and he is out of here.
Bill Elliott comes in. Kenny Wallace, Sterling Marlin. Bobby Labonte, Steve Hart. In the pit lane, so is Kevin Harvick and Michael Waltrip. There's Elliott's car.
Bill Elliott on the way down pit road. Pete Cherry's going to carry the front tires. The guy that's going to put him on is Andy Thurman. He is a driving school instructor. Ray Everham, high on the box, orchestrating this pit stop. So far, so good. New team, new car, new motors, new crew. Pretty much new crew. Some of these guys are left over. Elliott, he stalled. Elliott stalled the car. That cost him a second. A little less than 15-second pit stop.
Bobby Labonte completes his stop. Robert Presley is in. Steve Park getting service. Steve.
And Steve Park ran out of gas as he was making his entrance to pit road. They're having a hard time getting it refired. Take the windshield off, but he cannot get that car refired. He ran out of gas.
Now what the guy's doing right there, he's squirting fuel down in a tube that goes straight to the carburetor trying to get that thing to fuel to where it'll get cranked, Matt.
88 guys already around to the left side of the Dale Jarrett machine. His car was a little bit loose. Brad Parrott told me they were working on air pressure. They found something in their numbers. He should be better over this next run. The 20 car also going down pit road, as comes the 66 car into his pit stall. 3, 2, 1. His car had become progressively tight over that last run. They are going to adjust with air pressure. They talked about a chassis adjustment. Yes, the wedge wrench in the back window. Significant changes both sides as the crew guys come around the left side of the 66 car on four-tire stop for Todd Bodine. He did win the Busch race here yesterday. A slow stop. And now, finally, down the way.
Not a happy bunch right there. With a 20-second stop for Todd, who had assumed the lead during this cycle of green flag pit stops.
Now, here's our leader right now since we've cycled through, and what he's rewarded from is hitting a little bit early. Had that vibration, got those four fresh tires, now he's got the lead, Jeannie.
Well, Larry, you are exactly correct, and it is one of these four tires here, I guess we'll have to wait and find out, that was causing the vibration. He's been out, what, six, eight laps, air pressure's come back up, and that vibration is gone, so it is good news for Junior, and it's reflecting on the track.
He has a 1.1-second lead on Mark Martin. Sterling Marlin now third, Johnny Benson fourth, Bill Elliott fifth.
And, you know, we've seen the lead swap back and forth between two or three guys here, and most of that is due to what they do to the cars in the pits and the pit stops themselves. Haven't seen a lot of passing on the track, but there's been a lot of racing in the pits.
Is it more often this year just that we're taking more notice of it, that the drivers who come in first, short pit for a
car? Well, we got our car in the wall, turn three and four.
Oh, a hard hit as a car rolls down to the banking, and that is Hunt Strickland.
Hunt Strickland.
Caution's out for the fifth time today. And he pasted the wall. Earnhardt Jr. to bring the field around to caution. And it doesn't look as if anyone will get a lap back from Earnhardt.
We got about six cars that was almost fixed to go a lap down, and they're going to stay on the lead lap.
Ward Burton and Skinner, Kenseth.
Now, Strickland coasted around right to his pit stall. Make it easier to load that car on the truck.
I don't know. I think he's probably that's a hard lick in there. Imagine he wanted to get down there so somebody could help him get out of that thing.
A Calera, Alabama driver for Jenny Dunleavy.
If nothing else, it's absolutely knocked the wind out of him, and you can see him moving around in there, and he's going to be all right, but that was a hard lick.
I really don't think we'll see any cars on pit road, because remember, we just cycled through these green flag stops. The only car that could have a little bit of a decision to make is our leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr., because he has 13 laps on his tires.
Would you stop?
I would not stop. We saw what track position did a while ago, and we know everybody has to make one more stop to get into the race. No reason to stop.
Jeff Hammond, if that was your number eight car, would you stop now?
As good as it is right now, if he's still a bit tight, I'd come on in and get me four tires, because there's not that many cars on the lead lap. At the same time, 13 laps on tires against somebody that's only got two is pretty bad.
Just about half the field remains on the lead lap, as Jeff pointed out.
That's what I would have done.
He's coming.
You didn't ask me, but I'm sitting here saying, I know what I'd have done.
I was getting to you.
Okay.
But he got there first.
All right. He's got a few more laps on his tires, and I think that's a good move on his part.
More tires.
Now, Darrell, are you thinking like me, or am I thinking like you? If we can get back on track.
Warren Burton, Robert Presley, Elliott Sadler stopped. So did Matt Kenseth, Terry Labonte, and Jimmy Spencer. We'll be right back with more NASCAR on Fox. Get to. Tonight on Fox, Homer goes on a hunger strike on an all-new Simpsons. And will Reese's new talent be recipe for disaster on an all-new Malcolm in the Middle? Plus, the series premiere of Lone Gunman. It all starts with an all-new Futurama and King of the Hill. 7 o'clock, 6 Central, tonight on Fox. One lap to the restart. Mark Martin out front of Sterling Marlin, Johnny Benson, Bill Elliott, and Kurt Busch. Chris Myers.
Mike, so far this year, best finish for Mark Martin, the 20th. That was at the Rockhurst. Roush Racing has done quite well. As you get a look at the Hammond Hollywood Hotel, that's the back view. We are on the inside, just above Victory Lane. Let's talk about the strategy. And you called it moments before Dale Earnhardt Jr. went in, got four tires on a pit stop that took 14 and a half seconds compared to 20 for Todd Bodine, who lost the lead on that.
Well, what you're looking at right now, Chris, is a situation where I think that having four tires today has been critical. And what I'm seeing right now, what I'm really concerned with, is you got about 100 laps to go, and whether or not do I split the stop, come in early, get four tires, about 50 laps to go, and make a run to the end. It's helped the 8 car, and it's also helped, I think, the 22 car early on get back in the lead lap. So, you know, some pit strategies getting ready to develop down pit road.
All right, and so how about looking at the remaining laps here and who is in position as they're going green here? Martin would be the guy to bank on.
Right now, Mark's the guy up front. He knows how to win here at Las Vegas. So, you know, if you want to watch somebody, he'd be the cat to watch. It's time for Roush to break out. We keep talking about a slump. They haven't really been in a slump per se. It's only the third race, but for Roush Racing, they're in a slump.
Right. They've owned this track, and of course, Mark Martin has never finished out of the top 10 winning the inaugural race here in Las Vegas. Let's go back up to Mike Joy, Larry McReynolds, and Darrell Walton.
Mark Martin brings it to the green flag. Jack Roush has two cars in the top five. Rookie Kurt Busch is fifth in his hometown race in that white car on the right of your screen. Boy, Mark got a good jump on Sterling Marlin.
He really did. He anticipated that strong. But I'll tell you, the Dodge boys are looking pretty good. Sterling and Bill Elliott both up there in those Dodge cars. They really look like they're poised for a good one. Look to me like one of them might win the race.
All three of these cars, Martin in the 6, Marlin in the 40, Johnny Benson in the 10, all on the lead lap. They cleared the lead lap cars, or the lap cars that was on the inside. We've got 23 cars still on the lead lap.
Sterling Marlin closes up on Mark Martin here in the UAW-Daimler Chrysler 400 at Las Vegas. 101 laps to go. There are your first three cars and their speeds at present. Marlin is there. Marlin is going for the lead.
Looked like he got Mark a little bit loose over in turn four. See right there, he's 3 to 4 miles an hour faster because he got back to the gas sooner in turn three and four. Look at Johnny Benson. Move to the inside of Mark Martin. Mark's going to go all the way from first to third in one half the racetrack.
Yeah, he lost his momentum. When he got a little loose down, he had to get up out of the gas, and that cost him a lot of speed and cost him his momentum, and he's got shot by him. And these guys behind him, boys, they are doing some racing back there in the pack.
They were three wide in the middle of the backstretch and then got things sorted out.
This is Jeff Gordon in the 24 car going for 6 right there underneath Dale Jarrett. He's not really been in the picture, but he's done worked his way here.
What a race for the rookies. Kurt Busch in fifth, and Casey Atwood battling in that lead pack with Jason Leffler.
Whoa, look at Leffler, no one. Look at his hands. He's fighting that thing all the way off the board.
Like I said, what a race for the rookies.
That's right. They should have poor Robert Presser by now. He's holding the back.
Ricky Rudd, the 28 car, he's been trying to make that lap up for 100 and something laps where he had that flat earlier.
He has a good car, but he doesn't have a great car.
Todd Bodine in eighth place, touching with Stacy Compton, who's a lap down, and Ken Schrader. Now, Schrader is also one lap back. He's in 26th spot, battling Ricky Rudd for position. Down on the inside, 18, your Winston Cup champ, Bobby Labonte, comes fighting back in ninth place. The 14 right with him, Ron Hornaday, in 10th. Matt?
Lap 156, Mike. Bobby Labonte pitted for four tires. They made a slight air pressure adjustment. His car has been a tick loose all day. They're hoping the temperature continues to drop because they feel like the racetrack is coming to them. Bobby and Jimmy Mankar, his crew chief, have been talking about different drivers and teams, where they pitted and when they pitted, because they're trying to figure out when they should make their final pit stop. They can go about 60 laps on a tank of fuel.
Well, as the air temperature drops and we're cloudy, Darrell and Jeff, the track temperature cools off, and that gives the car more grip. So you're so hesitant that if you're a little loose, you need to adjust it, But I think the racetrack will tighten it.
Yeah, you keep thinking that, but I tell you, if you're loose, I've never had it. It always stays loose. You got to do a little something to fix that. A little air out of the right rear tire, a little wedge in, track bar, a little adjustment, some kind, half a pound, half a round. Do something to help me out, maybe even a tick of spoiler.
Just a little bit, because, again, we've got less than 100 laps to go, and you know you got another pit stop coming, so you've got to kind of gear everything up about air pressure. You can't get it too low because it's going to take too long for it to build back up. As we talked about in some other telecasts, sometimes you got to sacrifice a little bit so you don't lose track position and get too far behind the leader.
Kevin Harvick, 29, with Steve Park. A moment ago, you saw Tony Stewart. Remember last year, he was the fastest car at the end of the race. Oh, Park's going to slide right through the middle. No, he's not. They go too wide again.
Yeah, it's all three of them. A couple of children's cars there and an Earnhardt car. They're all racing each other pretty hard.
Battling Kenny Wallace, one of our No Bull 5 contenders. Jeannie?
Well, guys, we are in Vegas, so Dale Earnhardt Jr. decided to gamble during that last caution. He did decide to pit. They were all surprised that others did not come with him. Tony Urie told Jr., well, now we're going to find out just how good this car is.
It really was
the surprise, others didn't come with him because he had pitted so much earlier than everybody else. The other guys only had a couple laps on their tires.
Yeah, I think he'd have been a setting duck if he didn't come in because he, you know, he had 13 laps more than anybody else. So.
Boy, Dave Blaney, somebody ripped up his left front corner.
Busted his nose all up.
Sure, it's not hurting the aerodynamics, but at least not rubbing the tire.
Here's what happened to Blaney at the top of your screen.
Coming off of turn two over
Ryan
there.
Newman squeezed
him up. That's
Ryan
Newman right there in the 02 car squeezed him up in the outside wall.
Man. Good thing the nose gave. Could have had a heck of a wreck.
Gordon Burton back on the move there underneath Michael Waltrip. That's back at 20th place. And Terry Labonte fighting right with him.
Look at Robert Presley in the 77 car. He says, open it up, boys. I'm coming.
That's our Elvis.
Matt.
Bobby Labonte just radioed in, guys, I think the motor has let go. They are scrambling. They're going to try to work their way back to the garage, but this is going to be a tough blow for Bobby Labonte.
Last year, Labonte was only two drivers to finish every race. Dale Earnhardt was the other.
Not only did he finish every race, he runs all but 9 laps, and that's a lot of laps.
I don't see any smoke. Got a car spinning there, car 7.
Mike Wallace in the wall, turn 4, caution is out. 6th one of the day. Lap 176.
That was a slow spin, and he really just eased it up into the outside wall. He did a pretty good job of hanging on to that thing.
Yeah, but wait till he comes around, Darrell, and you see the angle of the rear spoiler, or what's left of it, on Jim Smith's Ford. Here's what happened to Mike Wallace. Might have been contact from the 44 Buckshot Jones.
I think he may have got a push. Not the good kind, either.
Another look at it.
Yeah, he just... And you never know what happened there. I mean, Buckshot obviously got into him, turned him around. But it's so easy, as we saw yesterday, to be in the gas, and all of a sudden the car starts to push or get a little loose. You got to get out of the throttle. The guy behind you doesn't anticipate that, and he'll get into the back of you.
New record for the number of cautions here at Las Vegas. We had 5 in 1999. This is the 6th one today.
Ryan Newman there in that blue and white car took evasive action in the nick of time.
One of the race records we don't like to set.
And we've run 12 laps, just like Dale Earnhardt Jr. had run earlier. I got to believe these guys are going to come to pit road and get them 4 tires because they're almost halfway through a run. Looks like it's going to be busy. Everybody's coming.
Well, when Sterling came in, remember, didn't he stay out on that last caution? That kind of set the tone?
But again, yeah, he set the precedence. Monkey see, monkey do. You everybody need to get back on sync here this near the end of the race.
Jeannie.
Well, guys, sometimes it's better to be lucky than good, and today Sterling Marlin is both lucky. The caution came out because he knew he needed one more stop. He gets just shy of 60 laps on his gas, and good because Marlin has said repeatedly this afternoon, I'm going to win this race. Matt?
The 10 car in the middle of your screen, it will be a 4-tire change for Johnny Benson. He said the car was just a tick tight, but they don't want to mess around the air pressure. It's Dick Berger.
Mark Burton is gone and away. Sean Parker has just fallen. He's the rear tire changer. He's on pit road. He is in pain. He apparently has injured his knee on this pit stop.
There's Parker taking off the headset. And looks like he's more mad than hurt. Yep. And here's Bobby Labonte on pit road with the hood up. Did you miss a lug nut?
I'm okay, Darryl? Guys. Don't worry.
He had his microphone up there like an antenna.
Well, I was having something to eat there, and I forgot I'd late raise it up. Well, the caution was out, you know. I figured on the caution, what the heck?
Labonte did not lose his engine. He is back underway and will rejoin this race, as will Mike Wallace. And we'll continue with NASCAR on Fox after this.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by UPS, the official delivery company of NASCAR. We want to race the truck. People love the truck.
NASCAR on Fox at Las Vegas, and the UAW Daimler Chrysler 400, 180 laps in the book, and a change of lead. Jerry Nadeau has gone to the front, came in 17th, now he's the leader. Sterling Marlin came in first, comes out second, but let me tell you, Travis Tritt played last night here in town, and he's got a song 10 feet tall and bulletproof. That is Bobby Labonte, because he had that engine problem or fuel starvation problem, coasted into the pits, and the caution came out, and Labonte is still on the lead lap.
I know this doesn't sound right, but that's how you win championships, guys.
That's right.
I'm just telling you, it just works that way for you sometimes.
These fellas, there's Martin Cronquist, the engine builder, in deep in that conversation. They've had 45 straight races that they've been running at the finish.
Listen to me. If you run another half a fuel stop and it starts doing it again, head for fuel and go right back out. Don't try to fix nothing. Tell Jimmy that.
I will.
How do you like being right in the huddle?
I like that, man. That strategy, and they're talking about what they need to do. They seem to think that it's probably doing it when the fuel burns out of the cell down to about half a tank, sounds like.
Let's update Mark Martin's stop, which has put him back in the field to eighth. Dick?
Well, Sean Parker was the young man that was injured in that. Sean, what happened during that pit stop?
Just trying to make a quick stop. We had a problem with the car stalling on pit road earlier today, and it's just instinct to help push the car off after a pit stop, and my hand got in there.
To help. Wait, it got in where?
And, well, in between the fender and the tire, and it's someplace where it shouldn't have been, but after the stop, I realized it was in the wrong place. And
are you going to be able to work on this car, do the rest of the pit stops today, Sean?
Oh, yeah. Hopefully, you know, we'll get another good stop here and be up front at the end of the race.
They're going green. Good luck with it, Sean.
I met Bobby Labonte on 45 straight races without a DNF coming into this season. Of course, he was in the big 19-car wreck in the Daytona 500.
Yeah, in rush hour yesterday. Now, this 25 car was in the top five as far as speeds go, so that's not a car as fast to be somebody to deal with here at the end.
17th coming in, first coming out of the pits, Jerry Nadeau leads them back to green.
All right, we saw the graphic. Jerry Nadeau come in running 17th. He's leading the race. Why? He changed two tires and everybody else changed four.
And that's a good strategy, I believe. I think that's going to pay off. We got him out front. Everybody gets out front, seems to be able to drive off and leave the crowd behind.
Well, if you always play follow the leader, that's what you're doing.
Somebody, Jason Leffler, got and brushed the concrete wall going into turn three there.
Got a little busy back there.
Yeah.
Got a little crowded back there. Well, I tell you what, it's showtime, far as I'm concerned, Larry. They can talk about what they want to, but it's time to bring in the racehorses.
Mark Martin on the move back up. He and Todd Bodine side by side for eight.
Now, Larry, did you tell me that we don't have to stop again?
No, everybody's got to stop one more time.
One more time. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, we got to get to lap 205. About 62 laps to go before we can do it. Oh, going to the end.
No way I can make it.
No way. Now, one of your cars many years ago.
Bill France asked me one time, he said, DW, how do you go so far on fuel? I said, sir, I got more than anybody else.
Todd Bodine just pulls the inside, goes right by Mark Martin in the sixth car.
That's eighth place.
Well, we know that car's fast, but he was early in the race. He led a lot of the laps, so maybe they got to dial back in.
He's running a place he wasn't running earlier. He's right around the bottom of this racetrack right now, which is a little easier to do sometimes on fresh tires.
Yeah, and you see how that thing leaps forward? That when he puts his foot in that thing and puts 800 horsepower to the ground, she leaps forward.
And he's able to stay in the throttle.
Let's show you what happened on the first lap of green going into turn number three. To Jason Man. Leffler, the 01.
I'm looking down the back straightaway, and this doesn't look possible. Whoa. and he knocked the fire out of that wall. He got into Bill Elliott. He got into Bill Elliott back there.
From Elliott's in-car camera.
Bill's trying to squeeze through there, and man, there's no place to go, Bill.
Leffler looked lucky to drive that one away.
He really was, and Bill's lucky, too, that he didn't take him into the wall with him. I got to believe that might have damaged Bill's car just a little bit.
Boy, you can't help but thank you. Look at Jerry Nay doing the 25 car. Here comes Jeff Gordon. Made a big leap on that last pit stop. I questioned, did he change four tires? They did change four tires in 14 seconds. And here's the other battle. This is for seventh.
Yeah, and just think about Jeff Gordon, guys. He's a no-bull driver. Somebody's got $1 million riding with him. And it's funny how the cream always seems to rise to the top, you know, right at the end of the day. Right when you least expect it.
How many times over Jeff Gordon's career have we not even pictured him in the race, and all of a sudden we get down to 50 to go, he's there.
That's old sneaky Pete, isn't it? He just slides right in there.
Still 80 laps to go now. Don't give this one away just yet.
Well, I'm not saying that we're... Certainly he's got to get to the lead, but where did he come from?
Here's Johnny Benson coming back after Kurt Busch for fifth place. What a drive Kurt Busch has had today.
Kurt Busch has been in the top five, top ten all day long, and just done an admirable job here. And I think that's some of that truck experience. Raced trucks here quite a bit. Seems to be paying off for him and Biffle Buckley that ran real well yesterday.
Kurt Busch started in ninth position, so not only did he be run well today, he started up here in the front.
Todd Bodine harassing Johnny Benson, the 10 car. Ford Pontiac Ford battling there.
Todd's really accelerating up off the corner well again. That's what he was doing earlier in the day. He seemed to have lost that, but he's got it back now. And he's putting the power to the ground right now, Larry. Man, I'll tell you, it's a good thing Benson let him go, because he slid right down in front of Benson and almost made contact.
Closing up on this group is Mark Martin, who just passed Bill Elliott.
But look at Johnny Benson in that 10 car. He's 5 miles an hour faster through the middle of the corner of these other two cars.
And we come back to Ketchingham's one thing, passing's another.
Todd didn't have any trouble doing that on this run. He must have got his best set of tires, and he's coming up through there pretty well. There's Todd. And you can see he's considerably faster than the other two. And you can see what it does for you, too. Look at that gap he opened up in just that one corner. He's 182 mile an hour down the back. A couple mile an hour faster than these two guys behind him, Busch and Benson. Comes up off that corner, got a great run. He's going to be doing 185 mile an hour easy going in turn one.
Benson takes another run, another look, but that's not going to happen right there.
The race has kind of gone full circle, you know. Todd and Dale Jarrett and some of those guys that were at the front earlier in the day kind of been back in the pack, but now they're working their way back up to the front.
Now here is Dale Jarrett, who's up at fourth place.
It's like they got shuffled back and they worked on their cars, and now when it counts, they're back up there running again.
But Todd Bodine is gaining fast on Jarrett.
Todd Bodine is gaining fast on everybody.
Jarrett led 42 laps of this race. Bodine has led 44. Mark Martin's led 54 laps, most of any driver.
Well, I'm starting to plan my pit strategy, Larry. Because I'm going to have to pit again, you said. I wasn't planning on it, but... All right, the leader's at the line now. Here he comes. He's at the line now. Here comes Dale Jarrett. Now.
And out of our Fox box, we'll show you the fastest five drivers. As they come through right now, Todd Bodine is the fastest driver on the racetrack on this lap.
Well, you can really see it on the racetrack, too. He is cutting that gap down in a hurry. He's up on the back of Jarrett. This is the way he ran when the race started, right here.
Sterling Marlin told his crew, I've got something for him. I've got a car that can win this race. And, Darrell, I'm not convinced he's wrong, but convinced he could be right. That's a better way of putting it. He's closing in.
I'm not convinced of anything yet.
On Jerry Nadeau. And we watch this battle, Dale Jarrett and Todd Bodine for fourth place.
And Larry, old Ricky Rudd is up there again trying to, been trying to get that lap back the whole race.
I mean, that's the biggest problem Jerry Nadeau's got right now, keeping the lead and trying to keep Ricky Rudd from dogging him up there trying to get that lap back. You look at Jerry Nadeau, one thing we hadn't mentioned, he's working without his crew chief, Tony Furr. Tony Furr's got one more week to stay at home from that rule infraction at Daytona. Gordon Gibbs is the acting crew chief, had to make that call a while ago for two tires.
I'll tell you what, Ricky Rudd's the hardest working man in show business today as he's back on the lead lap just barely. And Sterling Marlin, number 40, is right there to challenge for the lead.
I think the bigger story is that cat there in the back of the picture, that 24 car. Where did he come from? And when he gets that close to the front this late in the race, look out, folks.
Especially when there's $1 million.
And he's working on $1 million. And don't think he ain't considered that.
Here's where the Noble Five drivers are running. Gordon and Skinner has fought his way back up to the top 20.
Huge traditional and... also had got a lap down at one time and made it up when the caution come out.
Guys, I know we keep beating this kind of like a dead horse, but I'm telling you, this race is going to come down to pit strategy and who comes in when and whether they put on two tires, gas and go. It's going to be really, really crucial here as we get down to the end of this race. Who is holding, I think, the pad hand and who's going to blink first?
I told you to be planning the pit strategy. I said, come on, it's time to plan. Come on, man, talk to me.
I'll let you know when it gets close to time, D.
But I need to know now what I got to start to anticipate, what I got to do.
Stand on that gas.
All right. I'm up on the wheel. I got her. I've given her all I got right now.
Marlin and Gordon in second and third. Watch Ricky Rudd battle to get a lap back from race leader Jerry Nadeau. 70 laps to go. Pit stop. That final stop could come in as early as 10 laps. Or it could come in a while. We'll be right back to Las Vegas with more NASCAR on Fox. Ricky Rudd still battling to get around the outside now of Jerry Nadeau, but as he and Nadeau fought, Sterling Marlin slipped on past them both.
Yeah, he tried all he could to hold Sterling off, and Ricky Rudd's up in there doing all he can do to get a lap back.
Here's how it happened.
I think that 28 car is just worrying that 25 car to death. And of course, look who slips in there with him.
Jeff Gordon, part of this lead picture. Well, folks, let's take a minute and get you to exercise that volume control hand. Crank it up a little bit. Let's listen to these cars rumble around Las Vegas. Jerry Nadeau. You ride with Jarrett. Now chasing Todd Bodine.
I think what's happened here, Jerry Nadeau is a victim of two tires versus everybody else having four tires.
Yeah, it's a gamble that you take. But, you know, got him up front there for a little while. Let you know something I noticed about these cars. Because the temperature is so cool, there's a lot of tape on the grills. A lot of cars got a lot of tape on the grill. It doesn't let a lot of air go into the radiator. They don't need it. It's a cool day. That actually makes the cars handle a lot better. It just is a little bit of built-in downforce. I think that's why we're seeing as good a racing as we're seeing today.
There's the telemetry on Dale Jarrett. You see in the upper right his position on the racetrack. Now to start finish.
We talk about tape on the grill. This is a 24 car who's been working to the front all day long. Now he's sitting there in second place.
Look there, the black tape that's been added right there. Robbie Loomis and them, cooler temperatures. They decided, hey, we're running a little cool. We put some tape on the front of this thing. It'll run faster down the front straightaway. It reduces the drag. The air flows through the radiator opening. Puts more front downforce in that thing.
Yeah,
they
normally,
added that on a pit stop.
Normally it has some of that bottom even open down there on a track on a hot day, which that's a, lets a lot of air in there, and that's a lot of lift. Close the cars down.
Bobby Labonte way off pace, Darrell. Sterling Marlin just went past him, and you're going to see Jeff Gordon close right up on him. Labonte is way off pace. There's Sterling Marlin out front. He would gain a one place in the standings to the lead.
And with Rusty Wallace falling out of the race, already loaded up and head home, he is the, Sterling Marlin's the only driver now that has a chance of finishing in the top 10 in all three of the first races this year.
Johnny Benson battling Jerry Nadeau, who took just those two tires, and Benson moves up the spot. You know, the two biggest words to create demand in Las Vegas, sold out. And high marks to Chris Powell and his staff here, all 125,000 seats for this race, sold out for a market that's new to Winston Cup racing, but, and for all the different entertainment things going on in this city. That's quite an accomplishment.
Well, this city is sold out.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a million, what? You got 1.3 million live here now. The hotels here are absolutely incredible. I've never seen the changes that have gone on in the last 3 or 4 years here.
And I've never seen so many racetracks in one area. We got a mile and a half. We got a drag strip. We got a dirt track. We got a bull ring over here that's about a half mile. We got racetracks everywhere.
I bet they pay you a lot of money, don't they, Chris? To run all these tracks? Not enough? Well, we'll talk to Bruton about that.
It is a heck of a facility.
12 racetracks on this property.
This is a stadium. I mean, and if you put a wall around the whole thing, you're looking at a huge, huge, huge stadium.
Winston West ran here Wednesday night. World of Outlaws have run here the last two nights.
Well, I know when you're trying to sleep down there in the infield, there's race cars running until all hours of the morning.
I feel for you, Darrell.
Uh-huh. Well, those slot machines kept you awake all weekend.
No. Sterling Marlin in front. He leads Jeff Gordon by 1.4 seconds with Todd Bodine, Dale Jarrett, and Johnny Benson filling up the top five. We'll be right back.
NASCAR Winston Cup Racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Dodge and the UAW.
Is at Las Vegas, this beautiful motorsports facility and industrial park. Construction began 6 years ago, over 1,600 acres, 600,000 tons of concrete, and 10 million feet of steel to build more than 12 race courses here. And most of them have been in action at one point or another this week. Here's a list of the week's winners. Mark Reed pulled off a thriller in Winston West, Randy Swalwell in Grand American Modified. Friday, Andy Hillenburg, and Saturday, Danny Wood in the World of Outlaws. They'll run on the dirt track again tonight. And Todd Bodine won the NASCAR Busch Series race here yesterday.
I saw two of them and heard two of them.
Yeah. We're in the window for that final pit stop. Sterling Marlin is our leader now by just 1.8 seconds over Jeff Gordon. Steve Burns is in Sterling's pit.
Mike, let's find out. Lee McCall, what about your final strategy? Two tires versus four, what will you do?
Well, right now it looks like it's going to be four, but we'll kind of wait and see how that goes closer we get to our pit stop.
All right, Lee, let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Robbie Loomis is Jeff Gordon's crew chief. What are you guys going to do on the next pit stop, and how soon are you going to make that stop?
Well, we don't know. You know, some of these guys probably going to split up. We're probably going to go for a while and got to magically figure a way to get some tape on it and still make that motor live all day.
All right. They are having a little bit of a problem with overheating. Come at.
Todd Parrott is the crew chief for Dale Jarrett. You're currently fourth. What's the call going to be on your final stop?
Probably a little bit of gas and a whole lot of tires.
Two or four?
A whole lot of tires.
The genie.
A whole lot of tires is exactly what Jerry Nadeau did not do in his last pit stop, and he had a lot of heads turning. 25 cars saying, we will probably pit with about 18 laps to go. Two tires. Right now the car's a little tight. Too much bite in it.
And he has dropped to sixth place. Matt Hendrick Chevrolet.
That's the problem I had with taking two when he did. Now he's almost got to take four to be very competitive at all at the end.
Yeah, he'd have guys could probably take two.
He'd have way too many lap left side tires.
That's why when you get a chance to put four on, you put them on under a caution.
He's a former winner here. He won the Winston West race here in March of 1999.
But I got to call them a crew chief. Now, Larry, what am I going to do? How much longer before I pit?
Well, we're going to come in probably in about 20 laps. And if this thing don't get real ill with us, I may try to slide you enough gas to go to the end and get you two tires on there.
Okay, my car's good right
now. Right side tires.
My car's good. I'll keep you posted. I think two tires is the way to go. And listen, Larry, don't pack this thing full of fuel. Give me only just ever how much you need to get to the end.
You're not going to need much gas to get to the end. We're going to get them two right side tire changers done, Jeff Hammond. We're going to send him on his way.
That's the only chance you're going to have. If you're going to put on two tires, you can't wait on gas. You've got to get two tires on there and get out of there, because I guarantee you somebody is going to get two and will probably have a chance to win this thing. But somebody's going to stick four on this thing, and they're going to come at you pretty hard right there at the end.
Here's Steve Park trying to split what's been a great rookie battle. Kevin Harvick in 29. Kurt Busch, a hometown hero in the number 9. Running, they were 8th and 9th. Steve Park now splitting the middle.
The car that Kevin Harvick's driving, the 29 car, as he goes beneath Robbie Gordon there, who's several laps down, it's a car that Dale Earnhardt run at Homestead in November. But this car was almost given to Harvick and his group to use this year in the 7 races he was going to run. It's a car that he did about 5 tests, about 2,000 laps at Kentucky Speedway last year for Childress and for GM.
Yeah, that's a beautiful racetrack up in Kentucky, and we're going to do a Busch race there, all of us are, later on this summer, and look forward to that.
Up front, Jeff Gordon closing in on Sterling Marlin, whose last win, July 96 at Daytona, 151 races ago. Jeff Gordon closing up on the lead at 222 laps in Las Vegas. This is NASCAR on Fox. Welcome back to Las Vegas, where Jeff Gordon has taken the lead as Sterling Marlin slithered up the racetrack just a bit.
Yeah, they're going to need tires. These two cats, 88 and 66, they've been going at it hot and heavy here for about the last 5 laps. Jared had him pass once, and Todd fought back on the outside, a lot like he's doing right now. And Jared's teammate, Ricky Rudd, is just sitting there watching this whole thing and trying to figure out if he wants to help one or the other, I guess.
Now that's for third place, as you watch from Haviland on board Ricky Rudd's car, Haviland Cam. Bill Elliott has made the first of lead lap car pit stops. He took 4 tires.
He's at the line right now. And here comes the leader right now. That's how much he likes being lapped down.
And Buckshot Jones has taken his Petty Dodge to the garage.
But he made a good stop. Bill made a good stop and to get out in front of the leader, so if he catches a caution right now, I mean, he's not going to lose anything.
6 cautions today for 25 laps. We have tied the record for number of leaders, and we have a new record for the number of cautions at 6. 18 lead changes. The record is 25.
And where's all the heroes gone? Michael was up there early on. Mark Martin's been up there. There's Michael right there. But he's way back. He's not even in the top 10. Mark Martin led the race for a while. Where's Mark Martin?
Jerry Nadeau is coming on to pit road. He had slipped back to the tail of the top 10, Jeannie.
Well, guys, the 25 crew chief, Gordon Gibbs, said he can't afford to lose positioning, so he's planning to do 2 tires here. We'll take a look at this. Jerry Nadeau agreed. He said, hey, I need the best pit stop ever, and please leave my windshield, and also take one round of bite out, because this car is a bit tight. And yes, indeed, guys, 2 tires.
I disagree with that call right there, because that boy's had those left side tires on already for 60-something laps, and a left front tire here is important, especially with this tire package. And I heard a lot of teams saying they would wear the left front tire more than they was any tire, Jeff.
You're exactly right. Right now, Larry, one thing I've noticed already watching the lap time, Bill Elliott is coming, and he's coming fast. He's picking up almost 2.5 to 3 seconds a lap on the lead cars. So by getting in early, getting 4 tires, you better look for that 9 car. As I said earlier, he will probably inherit the lead before the end of this race.
Well, you're right, Jeff. I mean, just in the time that he came back on the racetrack, I'd say there was 100 yards between he and Gordon, and now there's probably 300 yards. Seeing Bill going down the back straightaway there. And he's right at 180 miles an hour entering into turn three. And you can see, look at him just blow by people.
Johnny Benson is on pit road.
That's Ward Burton that Bill's going by. And Ward's got a good race car, so that's how much faster Bill is.
Matt?
The call from James is the crew chief for Johnny Benson. Four tires. They thought about two, but they said, Johnny, I'm going to gamble with our win or top 10, 17.5. Do you want to win it? He says, that's why we came here. So they went with four tires.
Another little bit of insurance and changing four tires. Should we run a little bit and get the caution, you're certainly better off with four tires.
Ken Schrader just missed the entry to pit road. Here's Gordon. And a look at his speed on track. Here's the tri-oval.
And he's still carrying the speed at the end of the straightaway. Right there in the center of the corner, look at the difference in the center of the corner right there. That's the real difference right there between fresh tires and old tires.
But did you see 187 miles an hour into turn one? I mean, that's a couple of miles an hour faster than we've seen all day. So that tells you that he's picked up the pace.
Ricky Wright in the pit lane along with Casey Atwood and Ward Burton. This time Schrader makes it onto pit road along with Joe Nemechek and Dale Jarrett.
Yeah, Jarrett's in. Here comes Steve Park. I see how you crew chiefs do this now. As soon as a couple cars start pitting, you get nervous, don't you?
The reason you get nervous, you look at that stopwatch a half a second faster than you are. Dale Jarrett, he's in the pits.
Matt?
They were debating about whether to go two tires or four tires. Todd Parrish said we're going to go a whole lot of tires. They are making a chassis adjustment at a four-tire stop for Dale Jarrett. They saw that the 10 car took on four tires. They are going to take on four tires as well. 14.0 seconds. Dick Burberry.
Queen's winner Steve Park is on pit road. He is going to go for four tires. They have seen the speed that comes from four. Right sides are all on, but it's a bit slow on the left. To Steve.
Sterling Marlin in. They just lowered the track bar one round. He's a little loose coming off four. Darren Wolf to the front tires. Nathan Kennan to the rear tires.
Todd Bodine getting his stop completed. Michael Waltrip is also in. So is Tony Stewart and Kurt Busch. Matt?
The 66 car in. They are working on the left side. He is down to a 17.6 and Buell.
There's Kevin Harvick and the Richard Childress crew at work.
Dale Jr. is on the pit road.
Michael Waltrip in. Jeannie?
Michael took four tires. He's complaining the car is a little tight. Actually, he said his first 20 laps he really struggled. He's just trying to make up for some lost time, looking for some long runs here.
Taylor Earnhardt Jr. is in. Robert Presley's had a good race. He's been on the lead lap all day, and the leader's on pit road. Jeff Gordon comes in along with Jason Leffler, and Mark Martin comes to the pit lane. Dick?
Gordon's crew had discussed putting just two tires on it, but they saw everybody else firing four, and they too are going to fire four. Oh, and the number eight car just threw the catch can off the back end. Gordon slides to a stop at his pit. Boy, he came in here hard. Chris Anderson, the big man, on the track. So far, so good on this pit stop. This is the most important pit stop of the day. They get it right. They can win the race. They blow it. It's over. So far, so good. Boom! Gordon's down. Less than 15. Come at.
Two tires for Mark Martin. He's down and away. The 14 car is also in. They are completing work. Two tires for the 14 of Ron Horta. He's down and away.
Mark Martin is drawn to that inside straight, taking two tires.
Yes, he has, but I tell you, Dale Jarrett's pit stop was incredible. And so was Jeff Gordon. So they had incredible stops for four tires.
That was a catch can out there from Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car. And that is an infraction. He has been black flagged.
And that catch can, it catches the excess fuel that comes out the overflow. Plus, it has a probe on it that opens the vent that lets the fuel flow into it.
Matt Kenseth has assumed the lead. He is the 13th different leader of this race. That's a new record. Here's Earnhardt Jr. in for the penalty stop.
Boy, that's unfortunate. He was having a good run and not of his own doing.
Stop and go.
And what you're talking about, Larry, that probe that opens the vent, occasionally that can will stick.
Yes, it will. Sometimes the catch can man will get caught up in doing something else, and because it's hanging in there, the car drives away with it and still hung in there.
Well, a lot of times, too, the catch can man will take the first can and hold it while the second can goes in, and he gets mighty busy back there. Dale could have left in a hurry because it is under green. It's the most crucial stop he had to make.
As I watch the 17 car here, he'll be on pit road here shortly. His rear tire carrier had to go back home because Brian Dunaway, his dad passed away yesterday, so they've had to do some shuffling, so certainly our prayers and thoughts go with Brian Dunaway and his family.
Matt Kenseth, the leader. Elliott Sadler, who's on a little different pit stop sequence than the rest of these teams, is the second place car. Then Dale Jarrett and Jeff Gordon. There's Sadler just going past. Second. Kenseth, and look, these the drivers who will be the leader.
Dale Jarrett had an incredible stop. He would come in behind Gordon, went out in front of him, and of course they're going to be the leaders here in a minute. They got four tires. That's your race. Sterling Marlin is right there looming in the back. I don't know if he's got enough to pull up there to him or not to.
For the lead, not in the race at the moment, but when Kenseth and Sadler stop, this could be a defining moment of this race.
On the outside off turn two, he's going to beat him down in the corner. Bobby Labonte there in the 18 car. Jeff Gordon takes the position.
Ride with Dale Jarrett around Bobby Labonte. Jeff Gordon is a huge Formula One fan and especially notes the driving tactic of Michael Schumacher. What made Schumacher world champion last year in large part is he is the fastest into and out of the pits. And that was not lost on Jeff Gordon. He did a great job getting in and out. And maybe the leader when we come back to Las Vegas right after this.
Go on, take your money and run. Go on, take your money and run.
Those are your Noble 5 contenders, and here's where they're running in this race. And there are the fans they are paired with, standing up above Bobby Labonte's pit. Clanton, Alabama's Rodney Mims is amongst those fans, cheering on Jeff Gordon, who's in second place. There are the fans paired with the five drivers who finished second through sixth at Talladega last October. Of course, Dale Earnhardt won that race, so they elevated sixth place finisher Mike Skinner into the Noble 5. Matt Kenseth on pit road. Leader is in. This will move Jeff Gordon into the lead as Elliott Sadler had also made a pit stop.
And he only takes two tires, which again, 25 laps into this thing.
Yeah.
You know, taking four, he's going to be a lap down. Let's go roll the dice and see what we can come up with here as far as our finish.
Yeah, well, he's got the least amount of laps to run, so he can get by with two tires a little easier than some of the other guys can. So that's not a bad call on his part.
Young drivers are pretty good at spelling to make money. Jeff Burton has hit that Noble prize a couple times. Jeff Gordon has won it three times, twice in 1998, Indy and Charlotte, and then 99 at Daytona.
Man, I'd like to have been in a race one time and paid $1 million. I never was in one. I won Daytona in 89 and I paid $175,000 at the time. Let's go around the racetrack one time. I've been saying I'm getting kind of bored. I want to drive my car. Let's go down into, let's see, where are we here, guys? Coming to start and finish line, here we go. Swing her out next to the wall, drive off down into turn one at 185 mile an hour. Get that left front wheel right down on that white line. Back into gas, track's a little slick now, pushing off, off, off. Right out next to that wall, oh man, off of turn two. Gonna go down the back straightaway. I smell Jeff Gordon up there, I see him up there. Driving corner. Whoa, I drove in a real, oh. Man, good. I got down in there good. I'm on that white line. I'm back in the gas. Coming up off turn four. Here I come. Here I come. Whoa, man, I got close to that wall again. Drive down to the bottom, right on the apron, right at the start line. And, man, almost caught him.
Jeff, when he was driving with you as crew chief, did he do play-by-play every lap like that?
I'm going to tell you right now, Mike, the funny thing about it, a lot of times he would tease Mike, and I'm telling you, he talked to the race car a lot more than you'd think. Wouldn't be quite that graphic, but he'd be talking to that baby. Okay, baby, come on, right on that, easy, come on. Oh, good, 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 good. He'd talk to that car. I mean, he'd get it.
in tune with it, and they talk themselves right around there lap after lap. It was sometimes quite comical.
That's pretty neat.
And I talked to the car a lot nicer than I talked to him.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You got to love that car.
Hey, I'm glad we got that on tape right there.
No, the car would not talk back.
My problem right now is the verbal abuse I took from Darrell.
Kevin Harvick and Jimmy Spencer are battling for position. Spencer in 26, Harvick 29.
Harvick's doing a great job.
Yes, he has.
That moves him into ninth place, and to get a top 10 finish here at this place, guy's doing a good job.
He's closing in on ninth place Ron Hornaday in the green 14. Well, Jeff Gordon is coming up on a little bit of traffic. Robert Presley's been on the lead lap all day. He's the 16th place car. Now, Dale Jarrett has a car between himself and Jeff Gordon.
The problem for Dale Jarrett is not lap traffic. His car normally gets better as the run goes on, but Brad Parrott told me his car is now going to the tight side. They cannot reel in the 88 unless we get one more caution, which is unlikely.
Tony Stewart up to 13th place and back to 14th as he battles Bill Elliott.
And let me just say about Dale Jarrett or anybody. I know I've been in a car and they said, okay, it's time, showtime, pick it up. And when you start driving the car a little harder and going down in the corner a little harder, all of a sudden you realize, the car is not, it's not with me. It's not there for me. I got to slow down and kind of run the speed I was running. You always want to step it up at the end if you can, but sometimes it just doesn't work that way. And actually, you can overdrive the car, Larry. You know, you can drive it in too hard and get the car all messed up.
Larry, what's all that erector set in the side window there?
Well, what that is and what he's talking about is this right here. It's to put stiffener in that window. You want that window to be nice and stiff because if it starts sucking in and out with air blowing across it, it changes the airflow down the side of the car. It can hurt the downforce of the car.
I don't care about all that. It was those hoses that I'm worried about. Are they all opened up and hooked up?
That's because they're cooling you.
Nice, cool air blowing in there on the driver.
Jeff Gordon, 1.4 seconds ahead of Dale Jarrett. Sterling Marlin, it's Chevy, Ford, Dodge, Pontiac. Johnny Benson in fourth.
We showed our No Bull 5 fans there. Jeff Gordon is the only one of the No Bull 5 that's left on the lead lap right now, here with just a handful of laps to go.
There's the interval back to Dale Jarrett. Now you see the gap. Gordon at zero. He's the race leader. And you see how the gap changes in real time between he and Dale Jarrett on our Fox tracks.
Where it really made a change was off the corner. Dale Jarrett, we heard him say, he's pushing, he's tight. He can't stay in the throttle off the corner. Jeff Gordon can. He accelerates down the straightaway faster. See, right here, it closes up. Dale Jarrett's driving in deeper. Right here, it starts to really spread out and it carries all the way down that straightaway.
Now let's convert that to miles per hour. Speed at the end of the straightaway. And through the middle of the corner.
I just think the cooler temperatures, as well as everybody trying harder right now, has come down to the close. The speeds are up over what we saw earlier. A couple mile an hour into three and about 3 or 4 mile an hour into turn one. So they're driving in harder and getting around the track quicker.
Now that was very telling, Darrell, because Jeff Gordon's slowest speed in the middle of the corner, 142. Dale Jarrett's 139.
You just think back earlier today, you were talking about the only cars under 34 seconds. Look what they're running now. They're running 33 and a half seconds, 33.5. So that's how much they stepped up the pace here when the big money's on the line.
That last lap, 18 drivers ran laps under 34 seconds that last lap. Let's show you speeds at the line as of one lap ago. And who is quickest? Excuse me, as of right now, who is quickest on the lap just completed? Johnny Benson, class of the field right this instant.
And a mile an hour is a lot.
He's got a clean racetrack. The biggest problem he's got, though, is 5.5 seconds behind with 8 laps to go. There's no way to make that up.
No, he might catch Sterling Marlin, who's running third, but he's not going to catch the leaders.
Just not enough cars left in the deck for Benson. How about Dale Jarrett, though? 1.5 seconds behind Jeff Gordon.
Jeff Gordon's going to have to hit some pretty heavy lap traffic, and he's got some in front of him. But right now, that spotter's all over the top of this grandstand making deals. Let my driver get by you.
Yeah, Yeah, it's tense right now, even though Jeff Ford's car is running well and he's making good time around the racetrack. Buddy, when it gets down these closing laps, you don't want to make any mistakes. This one, you don't want to beat yourself. Let's see what they got to say.
Bob Jeffrey is the spotter for Dale Jarrett.
And he just told him the 02 knew that he was coming, so the 02 moved up out of Dale's way.
13th place battle, Elliott Stewart, and the rookie battle, Hornaday and Harvick for 8th place.
Hornaday's had a great run today. He's another one that's hung around the top 10 all day long, and now him and Harvick are going at it for top finishing rookies today. I believe Harvick may come out on top of that battle.
Kevin Harvick was a top finishing rookie at Rockingham as well a week ago in his first start in this car.
Elliott and Stewart continue their battle. Stewart uses the 01 of Leffler as a pick, completes the pass.
Bill's going to cut that 01 little slack this time. Run him up in the wall last time.
That was for 13th place. Two drivers who once in this race were contending for the lead. Jeff Gordon trying to hit the big casino here in Las Vegas and bank $1 million plus $1 million for Rodney Mims, who will suddenly have a lot of new friends down in Clanton, Alabama.
And how many sports do you know of? How many sports can you think of where you can win $1 million on one Sunday afternoon?
As a fan.
And standing in the building down there. As a fan down there in the pits, give me a break. These guys, they race for $1 million every week.
Yeah, some of us have to work a whole season.
I have to work a lot of seasons.
Right.
You know, you look at the 24 car. This team has just got stronger and stronger and stronger. Robbie Lewis went over there last year as the crew chief. They struggled, but you watched them in the last year. They kept coming. And it looks like right here, they're just about 3 laps to go for their first win of the season. It showed that, hey, we're here. We mean business.
Gordon's last win was at Richmond in September, 12 races ago. Maybe it's the flames, Darrell.
I think the flames are working today, boys. His car is red hot, and the rest of them ain't diddly squat.
Here to go, bud. Here to go. Nice and smooth, buddy.
Now, that's Ron Thiel, former Busch North Series driver, who is Jeff Gordon's race day spotter.
Boy, there's nothing any better. There's no greater sound than say you're pulling away. 10 to go, 5 to go, 3 to go, counting them down. No pressure from behind. Man, you want to hear all of that.
Remember, Gordon started back in 24th position.
Yes, he did. We didn't talk much about him early in the race. Matter of fact, most of the guys we talked about early in the race have kind of faded, but he's come on.
White flag. Bobby Labonte, bit of smoke as he comes around. He will complete this race.
Jeff Gordon got 1 3/4 second lead. Dave Blaney in a 93 in front of him. He just needs to ride there. They keeping him posted what's going on behind him.
Yeah, he's got a lot of lap cars in front of him, but Dale Jarrett still didn't have a chance to catch him no matter what happens.
Jeff Gordon's winning percentage is going to be about 1 in 5. It's his 260th Winston Cup race, and here comes Jeff Gordon. For his 53rd career Winston Cup win.
Hey,
Rodney, what are you gonna do with that million, buddy?
Viva Las Vegas! Aha! I hit the jackpot, Dan.
It's the first Chevrolet to win here. 3 wins and 3 races in 01.
Look at all the takes on that grill now, Larry. They're adding some more.
They keep adding it, making it better.
53 wins ties Gordon with Rusty Wallace, 8th on the all-time win list. It's Gordon's 37th Super Speedway win.
Oh, Rodney, he's in a little bit of shock.
Show me the money. That's what he's saying.
He is Jeff Gordon's new best friend.
That's right. Show me the money.
What a show. Jeff Gordon comes from deep in the pack to win at Las Vegas and break the Winston Cup bank. We'll be right back with NASCAR on Fox.
NASCAR Winston Cup racing from Las Vegas on Fox is brought to you by Conseco. By Labor Ready, dependable temporary labor guaranteed. By Napa Auto Parts. Napa, we keep America running. And by Coca-Cola. Enjoy.
There was a Dodge Intrepid pace car leading Jeff Gordon. But you see this armored truck? This should say Loomis Gordon and Company. I hope that's not $1 million flying out of the back of that truck as he goes toward victory lane.
Pennies from heaven right there.
Jeff Gordon's the winner. Chevy congratulates Jeff and the number 24 Monte Carlo on their big win today. As he'll tell you, the only thing that comes close to Monte Carlo's reputation on the track is its reputation on the street. Monte Carlo, more champions depend on Chevy, will be there.
Now that guy better take that $1 million and get out of town with it. You sure don't want to leave it here. And it's easy to do.
A prayer in victory lane with Jeff Gordon. And now, off comes that flame-painted helmet.
Yes, sir. I got them flames even on that helmet. My flames are good. I've always known that.
Oh, they were today. Chevy wins, Ford second, Dodge third, Pontiac fourth, parity, they call that.
Yeah, but
he already had an Oval 5 hat. He had it in the car with him.
I'm working on it.
It's three Chevrolet wins.
Where's my lovely wife?
He shut everybody else out.
There's Brooke. Congratulate Jeff. He now gets unhooked. There's what $1 million looks like. Somewhere in the midst of that is Steve Burns.
I think we're down here, Mike. Jeff Gordon talking to Jeff. $1 million. Congratulations. How'd you win this race?
We're back. Woo! Man, that was awesome. What a day. I don't know. We just never gave up. I guess the car was real tight at the beginning. I think the track maybe came to us because these guys loosened the car up. Just great communication. We never got frustrated. Man, I'm so excited about getting this new DuPont Flame Pepsi car in the Victor Lane. It's awesome.
Well, DW likes the flames. The young man you won the $1 million for is about to have a heart attack. I don't know about you.
I tell you what, I want to thank Winston for all that they do for our sport. I mean, to give $1 million to us drivers, hey, we don't need it, but to give a guy like this, $1 million, man. Are you excited?
Thanks a lot, man.
I bet the first half of the race, he didn't think I had a chance.
All right, great way to go. Guys, let's go to Matt Yoakum.
Well, Steve Dale Jarrett almost picked up some big money, setting himself up now for a run in Charlotte for the Noble 5. DJ, what happened over that last run? Did your car get tight?
Yeah, I'd just been tight. We were really good at the first of the race. Then I got a set of tires that just really spooked me. I was sideways doing everything, trying to keep it from wrecking every lap, and wasn't sure if it was that set of tires or if the track was changing, and so we made an adjustment, got it too tight. Then it looked like we got more cloud cover. It tightened up, and I just didn't get it freed up enough. They did a great job. Pit stops were incredible. Great engine. Just came up a little shy.
Well, he scores his best career finish here at Las Vegas and almost played a $1 million spoiler, Dick.
Sterling Marlin with a great year. He won his 125-miler at Daytona, finished 7th in the Daytona 500, 8th last week, 3rd today. What's next?
I don't know. It would be nice to go to Atlanta and win. I tell you, Chip Ganassi put together a great race team. Coors Light and Dodge Target in there with us, and got a great bunch of guys. A lot of hard work to shop, and I'm the same guy. I've been driving these cars for a while, and you get some good stuff, you can go good, and just like to thank them all. They really worked hard, and they deserve it.
What was it like out there today, Sterling?
Well, it was real tight early, and won't adjust on it, and we didn't do much, and the track kind of come to us, and we got real good by lap 200, and checked out and gone. I said, man, we got this thing, and just got too loose, and I thought we fixed enough toward end, and I just didn't have enough to catch the 88 and 24. We're still too loose, but it's a big improvement from last year, a whole lot from last year, and just like Rick said, I'm proud of all the guys for all the hard work today.
Nice job. Mike?
Thanks, Dick. 10th time in 16 runnings of the Noble 5 that the bonus has been won. And the fifth time that Gordon has banked a Winston Million. Look at that front four. Chevy, Ford, Dodge, Pontiac. Pretty close to parity.
All these guys be eligible for that Winston Million when we go to Charlotte in May.
Right. Of course, Chevy's won all three races. Some folks won't call that parity, but Look at Kevin Harvick, the highest finishing rookie there in eighth place.
And Hornaday right behind him. They fought it right to the end.
And Kurt Busch in 11th. Good day for most of the rookie crop.
All the rookies. Mikey fought back. Bill Elliott, who led early, kind of faded at the end.
Robert Presley stayed on the lead lap most all day, and Mike Skinner came up from provisional land at the start.
Ricky Rudd, he had a top five car all day long. He just couldn't get that lap made up.
He raced everybody, but he was just a lap down the whole time.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. had that penalty on pit road with that catch can. Bobby Labonte, 29, still putting around it.
But he finished.
But he
did finish.
That's right.
Robbie Gordon suffered a pit penalty for too fast on pit road his last stop, dropped him to 34th. Buckshot Jones not running at the finish. John Andretti and Brett Bodine and Jeff Burton did get back on track. These cars were out of the race. Here's today's Pep Boys trivia. We've had nine different winners in the last nine Winston Cup races. Put your thinking cap on. What was the record? I'll tell you when we come back. Jeff Gordon has won the Noble 5 and the $1 million bonus, broke the bank here at Las Vegas. We'll be right back with more NASCAR on Fox. Fireworks in the air here some 10 miles north of the Las Vegas Strip, celebrating Jeff Gordon's breaking of the bank here in Las Vegas. All right, what's the modern era record number of consecutive different winners?
I believe it's 11.
Larry?
I was going to say 10 or 11.
I was going to say 14 until I saw 11 come up on the screen. Good job, Darrell. 1985 and 86. Let's meet the highest finishing rookie of the race.
Yes, I'm with Kevin Harvick, a rookie on the move in more ways than one, because there's a police escort to get out of this place. Well-deserved. 14th place at Rockingham, 8th place here. You're improving each week. How are you feeling behind the wheel?
I'm starting to get used to long races. I think that was my biggest concern coming in, and all that time in the gym is paying off for me. And, you know, the GM Goodrich team, I mean, they had a solid foundation, and they had an awesome driver. So I think I'm just trying to get accustomed to them. If we keep doing what we're doing and just finishing all the races, we'll be fine.
Getting used to the racetrack and getting used to the car and getting used to married life as well. We'll let you get the heck out of here. Congratulations.
Thank
again.
You.
Kevin, in case you missed it, got married earlier this week. Matt?
Johnny Benson finished fourth. His ties his best finish here back in 1998. That car looked very good all day.
It was. I mean, Belleville and Pontiac was really good most of the day and just got a little too tight there the last two stops. And not really going to complain, though. James Ensign and the guys is doing a tremendous job. Made a couple bucks for the Caring Hands program that Belleville has. I'm real excited about that. And just looking for a good year this year.
And it could be a big money year. He is now set up for the first time ever to be eligible for the Noble 5, Dick.
Todd Bodine finished fifth today. Looked like a winner for a while. What happened that you didn't win it?
Well, we just missed the setup a little bit. The car was great in the beginning, but as the race went on, the racetrack got tighter and tighter, and we didn't quite keep up with it. We were always one step behind, but we got it the best it was at the end and got by Mark for fifth. And Kmart Taurus, we did what we had to do. You know, like I said earlier, if we had a top 10 car, that's what we had to do. If we had a car to win, we could win. But we had to get a good finish, get some points, show what this team is about and what we can do. I mean, this hopefully this is a sign of things to come, and I'm pretty excited about it.
Well, you've had a great start to this year. A couple of wins with the Busch Series car, a top five here today. What do you expect for the remainder of this year?
Well, I don't know. You know, go out and give 110% every lap. That's my philosophy, and what happens, happens. The Busch car's been running great. We're going to run that Atlanta again, and this car, we're really getting our ducks in a row. We're getting things lined up. We're looking for the future, trying to get things in place, and Travis and Carl have given us everything we need, so it's up to us to do it, and I think we can. I want to say hi to Ashlyn Lynn. Hi.
Okay, let's go up to Mike. I bet you he is going to win this year, Mike Joy.
Thanks, Dick. It's quite a progress for that team, and here is Jeff Gordon, our winner, celebrating with and our Winston Cup points. Sterling Marlin goes to the point lead. Jeff Gordon to second. Michael Waltrip third. Dale Jarrett, Steve Hart. And on back through Elliott Sadler, who rounds out the top 10. Now, Todd Bodine won the Busch race here yesterday in the NASCAR Busch Series standings. Show him fifth in points behind a tie for the lead. Jeff Green and Kevin Harvick. Then Greg Biffle and Jason Keller. And here's a look at the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series point standing going into this weekend. Brought to you by Sears. Joe Rutman, the point leader after Daytona. Ricky Hendricks, Scott Riggs, Lance Norrick, and Randy Tolsma. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Las Vegas. Here's where the Koch family of drivers finished today. All five of these drivers were on the lead lap, led by Dale Jarrett, in second place. Ricky Rudd fought to get back on the lead lap all day. Bobby Labonte coasted to the finish. John Andretti, Jeff Burton with problems. And tonight on Fox, Homer goes on a hunger strike in an all-new Simpsons. And will Reese's new talent be recipe for disaster? It's an all-new Malcolm. And the series premiere of Lone Gunman. It all starts with a new Futurama and King of the Hill at 7 p.m., 6 Central, tonight on Fox. Matt?
Well, Mike, head engine builder Mark Cronquist, crew chief Jimmy Makar, and the guys are looking over the 18 cars, seeing what might have been the culprit for their engine woes. Bobby, any idea?
We had lost fuel pressure, and then we lost a valve or a piston or both, and then kind of just rode around after that.
Well, a tough day for Bobby Labonte. Two finishes this season already outside of the top 20. Dick?
Casey Atwood, rookie, ran all day today. What'd you learn?
Well, we've learned a lot, and I've run five or six Winston Cup races now, and we finished all of them. We hadn't got any wrecks, and we've been struggling a little bit. We were really tight all day. We had a couple sets of tires that didn't really feel good to me, and just building up way too much air pressure in the right front. We had that same problem happy hour, but we're learning a lot each and every week, and we'll be a lot better when we come back to these places. But had a lot of sponsors here this week with UAW and Dodge, and we really wanted to run good for them, but Bill had a good run, so it was a pretty good weekend for us.
And he brought it home whole. Let's go to Chris.
All right, thanks very much. In our location here, just above Victory Lane, let's take a quick look at what happened when the race started. Two-time defending champ Jeff Burton on the second lap, spinning out of control and was not a factor after that.
Penske cars of Rusty Wallace and Jeremy Mayfield get together and into the wall.
Then Dale Jarrett, the pole sitter, pushing into the lead in his car. We had a number of caution flags, in fact, a record caution flags here as Joe Nemechek and John Andretti.
Yeah, the air got off of Joe Nemechek's floor, and around he went, took John with him. Bill Elliott looked very strong, looked like the Dodge may come in here and win a race today. Took the lead away from Mark Martin.
Then another Dodge in Sterling Marlin, making his move late, actually held the lead for a while. But in the end, Jeff Gordon, who took over on lap 248 and led for 33 laps to win his 53rd Winston Cup title, holding off over the last few laps to capture the checkered flag, the $1 million bonus, not only for him and his crew, but also for a lucky fan from Alabama, Rodney Mims, cashing in. And for Jeff Gordon, you know, in a city like Las Vegas, Jeff Hammond, kind of like the guy who starts out his first night at the tables and gets down in a hurry. He's in a lot of trouble. He started 24th, right, but he was very patient. He didn't panic, and in the end, he cashed in on $1 million.
Well, what you saw right there, Chris, was a veteran racer coming right through, because Robbie Loomis has got a lot of experience. Jeff Gordon, he knows how to win. So you take those two guys, combine them together, and they realize this is a long race. They kept working on a race car, and in the end, here they come.
All right, and a record, a no bowl five for Jeff Gordon, the fourth time he's cashed in on the million. He's batting .500. He's been in this thing for eight times. Let's get out with Steve Burns, who is standing by with the lucky fan, who's a very rich fan. Steve?
Yeah, and that's Rodney Mims from Clanton, Alabama. Rodney, the big question of the day is, how do you spend $1 million?
I don't know where to start.
You want some help?
I can figure it out.
You have no idea of how to spend $1 million.
Oh, yeah.
Well, what are you going to do with it?
I'm going to live it up in Las Vegas for a little while.
That's the short term. How about long term?
I'm going to invest it. Start my own business, probably.
All right, smart man. Let's go to Jeannie's Alaska.
Well, Michael Waltrip with a 13th place finish here today. Now, you were talking early on, at least to the pits, through the headsets we could hear. You were upset about the first 20 laps?
Yeah, I was loose on stickers, and then I would get good, and we spent more time of our day outrunning the leaders than we did getting outrun by them. But we just give up too much on the initial get-go with our Napa Auto Parts Klausner Furniture Chevy, and that put us behind. We finished 13th.
What are you looking at here? I guess we could share this with everybody if you could see it.
This is the finishing order. It tells you the laps completed. It also is a rundown of the points. And it tells us that we are still third in the points, which is far cry better than we were a year ago at this time. And I'm a numbers person. I dissect this stuff and read it every way from Sunday just to see what's up with it. And I'll take this home and study it all and figure out what we need to do at Atlanta to be better. We are real close to being a good team. I believe that with my heart. We're fast at times. Are y'all live or are we taped?
We are live, sir. We are live. There you go.
Hi up there, big bro. How's it going?
It's a family affair.
But it's just real close to being a great team, and I'm real thankful for the effort everybody gave me today. Just like that much, and you know how frustrating it is, DW, when you're just that much short. But thanks to all my sponsors, and thanks to Fox for doing such a good job showing our races to the public. It's fun to watch you guys.
Very nice of you to say. I'll let you continue your homework. Chris, back to you.
All right, thanks, Jenny. We'll give Michael a job in our promo department. So Chevy has won the first...
I like Michael.
Chevy has won the first three races here. Jeff, Sterling Marlin is the only guy who's finished in the top 10 in the first three races. He's the new points leader. What about Rusty Wallace, who was the points leader coming into today, but the Penske team kind of took each other out early in this race, and he did not finish, went home early.
That's right. I'll tell you right now, I would be worried right now if I was Roger Penske, because he'd have to try to get all his drivers together. And let's see, what happened, guys? I mean, it was only the seventh lap of the race. What happened? Was it cold tires? Was it oil in the racetrack? I mean, Jeremy got into Rusty, and I mean, that pretty much ruined the day for both cars.
Yeah, Rusty Wallace told me this week that Las Vegas is one of the great stops here because it's a big social scene. Your sponsors come here. They bring people to entertain, so it puts a little bit more pressure. Speaking of pressure, Roush Racing, they've owned this track. Finally, their streak is stopped. Mark Martin had the lead just past the halfway point. I think he wound up sixth in this thing. But what happened, and where do they stand in the big picture?
Well, the big picture right now is, Chris, at least they got a finish, a decent finish under their belt. Obviously, they made a mistake right there toward the end, or the racetrack changed a little bit, and they didn't quite keep up with it. Now, Jimmy Fennick and Mark are very sharp about adjusting their race cars, but today, if you didn't get off of pit road good and make exactly the right adjustment, I mean, a half a pound would make a big difference in your race car, so therefore, it didn't work out as good as they wanted to, but they at least got a solid finish. But what about Kurt Busch? He has got some promise, and maybe that's where the salvation of Roush Racing is going to come from.
Finishing 11th, real quick, looking ahead to Atlanta, you were inspired by the rookies and the Kevin Harvick finish, something to watch for next week.
Kevin Harvick and Richard Childers right now are doing an outstanding job. I mean, it seems like each week he gets better, better, better. So next thing you know, he's going to be up there and contending for a win if you're not careful.
Jeff Gordon, your winner. Dale Jarrett, who was on the pole.
And Todd Bodine, what a great finish for him.
Coming in second, and Richard Harvick, as you just mentioned, eighth, one of the rookies, Ron Hornaday. Let's go back upstairs now to Kevin Harvick there finishing eighth, to Mike Joy. Mike?
Well, have you looked down through the order of finish? A really fun race to watch today. Now, how about next? We've had more competitive races this year to last year compared, and we go to Atlanta, Darrell, because last year, a photo finish there. You can't get much more exciting than that.
We continue to have great racing. I've seen the best racing I've seen in years. I tell you, we've had record lead changes, different people up there all the time, and you think the racing's been good to now. You wait till we get to that 200-mile-an-hour, mile-and-a-half speedway. At Atlanta, you're not only going to see racing, you're going to see a lot of action and a lot of passing.
And what I like about today, we had talked about it a bit. I know Chevrolet's won the first three races. All the manufacturers so strong, and at the end of the day, we had Chevrolet, Ford, Dodge, and Pontiac in the top four positions.
Right, but remember, only Chevrolet has been in the winner's circle with all three races so far this year. Let's go back down to Chris Myers.
At our lineup tonight on Fox, stay right here. Homer goes on a hunger strike, an all-new episode of The Simpsons. Will Reese's new talent be a recipe for disaster? An all-new Malcolm, plus it's the series premiere of The Lone Gunman. It all starts with an all-new Futurama and King of the Hill. Next, except on the West Coast, Jeff Gordon, King of the Hill here in Las Vegas, as more than 125,000 fans packing the Las Vegas Speedway to watch Jeff Gordon cash in with $1 million bonus and help a fan with $1 million as well. Next Friday, be with us from Atlanta, Winston Cup qualifying. That's on Fox Sports Net. Saturday, the Busch Series race and more practice from the Winston Cup cars. That's on FX. And then, of course, next Sunday's race right here on Fox. For Mike Joy, Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, Jeff Hammond, and all our people in the pit crew, I'm Chris Myers. Thanks for being with us on Fox. We'll see you next weekend, as it was a terrific day. The weather held off. Roush Racing, disappointing. A number of caution flags, the glitz and glamour. The showgirls went down to the millionaires later in the race. It really was awesome as we watched Jeff Gordon win his first race of this young season. Dale Earnhardt Jr. finishing in disappointment. Chevy has won the first three Winston Cup races this year.